We're always in our clubhouse getting high.
Superfuckers!
Everybody wishes we would die.
Superfuckers!
Here we come, like a bomb. Everybody fucking run and hide.
Hey, it's the Pizza Party Podcast. I'm John Leguizamo. Who are you people?
What the fuck?
It's me.
Yeah, really?
It's me, John Leguizamo. I was in the Super Mario Bros. Movie and Ice Age. I was Sid the Sloth. You guys remember me? Who are you people?
Wait, is this really John Leguizamo?
It's me. Who are you?
John Leguizamo.
Stupid fuck.
You owe me like a lot of money from babysitting your kids.
I don't know what you're talking about, but anyway, who are you people?
Hey, it's me, Rayman. I can't do the voice, but just pretend it's me anyway. I'm Rayman. Hey, everybody.
That's not you.
I was that mammoth in Ice Age, and I was on Everybody Loves Rayman because everybody loves me. I'm Rayman.
Wait, you're talking about the...
Come on, guy, that one!
yeah, I was Rayman. That's me.
Oh, wow.
That's me!
Hey, we're going to announce that we're going to make another Ice Age movie. It's going to be amazing.
Oh, man, another paycheck, finally.
Yes, I don't have any other work. I was in the Justin Bieber music video, the one in the beginning. I was there.
He was?
Yes, I was.
I'm sorry, you were?
Yeah, that's me. Yeah, I'm John Leguizamo.
I would 100% believe it because I have yet to see a single Justin Bieber music video.
It was What Do You Mean? That song. I was in the beginning. I was a drug dealer, I think. I don't remember. They paid me. I just showed up.
Wait, what do you mean?
Fuck off.
No, just that kidding. It wasn't John Leguizamo. It was me. I fooled all of you. There, it's me.
What?
My God, what the fuck?
Yeah.
I'm a little ashamed.
I'm so mad. I'm going to go make some mac and cheese.
Here. So, yeah, Stev Rape Bro is back, everyone. Who are you, Stev? What do you do?
I think you kind of hit the... I'm Stev Rape Bro. I make a lot of animations for other people's channels. I currently have open... A Yamama joke, which it's Dragon Ball Z, and I'm drawing Nappa, and guess what meme they used?
Oh, are they going to use the 9,000?
That's the whole joke!
Oh, snap! They're going to do it! And yeah, and also, Jim, did you do something special recently that people demanded?
I finally reviewed Rent.
He reviewed Rent? He reviewed Rent, everyone!
I haven't seen it yet! I better go.
Yes, I actually did review. It was a real review. I actually reviewed it.
Damn.
I don't think anyone thought I was going to really do it, but I did it.
He fucking
did the whole thing. I was waiting for the punchline.
Yeah, people were like it's going to be a joke. And I was like, no, I was serious. Like, I thought the most surprising thing to do was to just review it.
Fucking just give up.
Yeah, just like if I made it a joke, then people would go, yeah, but when are you really going to review it?
No.
You know? So, yeah, now it's over. Now I get to pick what movie Nolan, a terrible movie Nolan has to. Not that Rent's that terrible, but.
Well, Jim's going to make me suffer anyway for all those messages in his box.
So, wait, should I reveal? I have two picks.
Now or never.
Okay, so I have two of them. Nolan, you can pick which one you want to do.
How about the fans pick which one?
Okay, all right. Then I don't think you're going to like either of these then. The first pick is, how do they pick? Are they just going to do, how did they pick?
They're just
gonna, in the comments.
Yeah, in the comments, say, pick which movie Nolan wants to review, and in front of it, put Nolan should review, and then that way Pan can find it easier.
Yeah, just write Nolan should review and your choice. So what's the choices?
Okay, so the first one's a little typical and a fan servicey, but I'm doing it anyway. First one is Rocket Power Race Across New Zealand.
Oh, fuck!
I actually, when you were like, you have to pick a movie, I put in Google Rocket Power movie to see what came up.
Now we know what they're going to fucking pick.
And what's the other choice?
No, wait. The second one is a good contender. It's like the person who's a good contender. I don't know. the second one is The Oogie Loves in the Big Balloon Adventure.
No. Oh, that one.
I honestly don't know which one I want you to do more, but I know Rocket Power Race Across New Zealand is available on YouTube in numerous parts and is shooby-licious.
Yeah.
Shooby-licious, god fucking damn it. All right. We okay, so I guess for voting, we'll just wait. We'll announce the winner the next episode. Is that cool with you, Pan?
Sure. Yeah. So yeah, choose between just type out Nolan should review and then either put Rocket Power Race to New Zealand or the Oogie Loves Big Balloony Adventure.
And then whichever one wins, I'll do a review.
Yeah.
And but don't do it too quickly. You can make people wait.
Do you have a YouTube channel
I'll put a link on my Tumblr when I upload it, but I plan on making it a big spectacle. Let's just say that.
Yeah.
I mean, my budget is kind of limited right now, so it's going to take a while to get everything I need, but just
get a green blanket. You got a green screen right there. You can do that and make all the reviews you want.
Yeah. Basically.
You can just make a 30-minute long skit and pass it off as a review.
That's basically what I was planning.
Yeah.
I mean, I use a green screen. I don't even actually have a bookcase. That's all green screen.
I've been doing
that's
the hard
true.
Way.
Jim's videos are way more technically superior than you'd expect them being.
Yeah, people always are like when I told them the shark moves each video, they're like, wow, that probably doesn't take that much effort. That literally takes me like a whole day to decide where the shark, and then it's got to render. Like, I have a huge render farm in my apartment.
But hey, the next video, it's going to be a video on the night before Christmas. If anyone knows this, it's the more urban take on some sort of Christmas story. They played on Cartoon Network a long time ago. Anyone remember this?
I kind of do, actually.
I mean, if you search Google for it, you'll probably recognize it. The night letter B and number 4 Christmas, night before Christmas. And features a guy who was on Mad TV once.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I haven't seen it, but I've seen it.
Okay.
I haven't like watched it, but I'm aware of it. Like okay.
You know it exists.
Yeah. Thanks for. I think I blocked my memory from it.
Well, they would play that a lot in Cartoon Network in the 2000s. I mean, it's one the Christmas. I remember seeing it a few times.
I remember the little dog that wants to be a reindeer.
Oh yeah, all of the other reindeer.
Yeah. Like I remember that. I remember that playing a lot.
Yeah, they were really trying to make new Christmas specials for a little bit.
But the only one that stuck was Grandma Got Run Over by a Reindeer.
Well, that's because that one syndicated. Ugh. And like who cares what comes on the Saturday at 4 p.m. before Christmas, you know?
Yeah. It's like, I mean, that one
always plays. Ugh.
I get two requests that people want me to review a bunch for Christmas. Either Adam Sandler's 8 Crazy Nights or... Grandma Got Run Over by a Reindeer.
Really?
Yeah.
The weirdest thing about 8 Crazy Nights is he had 2 movies come out right around the time. It was 8 Crazy Nights and Punch Drunk Love.
Yeah.
And he's like really good in Punch Drunk Love. And I was like, oh, this movie's great. I can't believe Adam Sandler would do it. I'm sure it'll do really well. And he refused to promote that, but he promoted 8 Crazy Nights like crazy. I was like, thanks a lot, Adam Sandler.
I was watching 8 Crazy Nights like a couple of days ago. That movie's a fucking mess. That movie's so bad.
How did you not go, I watched 8 Crazy Nights 8 Crazy Nights ago? That's what you said.
Because it was like 3 days ago. That's the
You don't need to be honest. No one needs to know. Just say it was 8 Crazy Nights ago.
I mean, imagine if I make an entire movie with Emily and Stephanie... And just their annoying voices, like, this is 8 Crazy Nights. It's just Adam Sandler doing funny voices.
Well, how many characters does he do?
He does himself, but himself as a 19-year-old, apparently. Like, I saw some bonus feature, and apparently that his character in 8 Crazy Nights is supposed to be him as a 19-year-old.
Bullshit. No.
That doesn't work. You think it's Adam Sandler, so you think he's, like, in his 30s or whatever.
At minimum 25.
Yeah, but he plays these twin... old people who talks like this, everyone. It's me, Adam Sandler. You guys want to see my movie? And that he talks like that through the whole thing. It's fucking
awful. I'm going to be honest. I think 8 Crazy Nights would be more fun for you to review than Grandmother Got Hit by a Reindeer.
close enough. Yeah,
I've never watched all of the Grandmother Governor by Randy Review.
It's just not like Eight Crazy Nights is at least enjoyably bad. Like it's one of those movies you could probably like sit there and just shit on it with your friends.
It's not enjoyably at all.
But like I don't know, I really hate. Your grandmother got hit by a reindeer. Like, I don't think it's funny. I don't think it's entertaining. I just think it's like white bread.
I mean, no one talks about the songs really about how someone's grandmother was murdered by a reindeer.
Yeah, I always find that that's kind of not fucked up.
That's not funny. That's not funny.
Yeah, fucking.
You know, that you have to spend Christmas in the hospital because your grandmother got injured by a reindeer.
Absolutely that's terrible.
Cool. That's not cool. That wasn't me being funny. That was being real, kids.
Yeah. Fuck
being
that
real.
Fuck them in the ass all over. So, you guys want to get into the news?
Yeah!
Okay.
Sure.
Toys are up in your face. Toys. Who bites the race? Toys. When I'm done with you, they won't recognize your face.
Regular show toys. You control the action. Toys. It's almost as good as the real thing. Collect them all, each sold separately, available exclusively at Toys R Us.
Hey, I was in a 107 Facts Frederator video, 107 Facts about Regular Show. Hey, did you guys know that Regular Show uses music from the 80s?
What?
Yeah!
Whoa.
I couldn't believe it. It's almost like you gotta watch the show to figure it out, you know?
Whoa, what are some other facts?
Oh man, like J.G. Quintel, the creator of the show, voices Mordecai. Did you know that?
Did what? You know that J.G. Quintel has a diaper fetish?
We don't know if that's for sure or not, you know, but it's possible. We don't know. Because there's several episodes that involve Mordecai in a diaper, and we're just like...
Wait, was that in the Did You Know?
Sadly, no.
It should have been.
What's funny is that I actually recorded it twice because the first time what happened was is they messaged me saying, hey, want to do this? All you got to do is narrate and we'll edit it and everything. So I did. And the first take had a whole bunch of like very self-hating, angry comments like saying, you would know that if you saw the show. And other angry things. And they said, yeah, you're right, Pan. Our script writer did let us down. We're going to rewrite this and we're going to have you record it again. So that's the second take they did for 107 Facts. They added some things to the new one.
Wait, so you recorded one where you're basically making fun of it while doing it?
Yeah, where I'm a huge asshole, which I still have the original recording on my mega upload.
Oh my god, that's
you should
like
upload on your own channel.
Yeah,
that's really funny. That's
maybe I should just dump it on like in the description, like the download file for the original one. I don't know, although I don't know if Frederator will be like that at all.
I don't think they would like that.
No.
Yeah.
Hey, did okay. you but know? Did
I'm
you
just
know
surprised
that Mark...
they were like, "Wow, Pan, you really showed us the way."
I'm sorry.
Did you know that Mark Hamill does a voice on Regular Show?
What?
So I got to do one as well. Oh, I did the 107 Facts about Steven Universe, and I was the first of the like trial of that, and. I have a couple, a handful of stories on that. First off, my facts are all fake. They like pulled it from that fake Steven Universe like wiki, Tumblr. Yeah, like a good majority of the facts they pulled off that were sourced from that site where someone just trolly makes up random fake facts.
God damn it! which ones did they put in?
I did this like last year. Or not last year, like earlier in the year, but like I can't remember which ones, but they're all like kind of like they sound real enough that like if you watched it, people would believe it, you know?
Wow.
And then I recorded mine twice as well, but I was sick.
Uh-huh.
And so like I wound up going into a closet and then recording and just dying. So like because I thought
when you said sick, you meant you were so good at it. The recording was sick.
Okay. No, I'm like, oh, OK. So 107, like it was just really bad. And like they somehow managed to get all the takes that they needed. And the funniest thing for me was I did a bit where I sung the theme song. Because, like, they didn't really have a script for the beginning part. And I was like, all right, I'll introduce myself. and I did it. And then apparently they thought it was really good, but instead they redubbed it themselves. So whoever announced it did that bit.
That's weird. That's like ripping you off.
That's fine. And then the last thing I have to say about it is that there's apparently a girl, Happy Go Lucky, I think is her name. And she does the thing where like you record yourself watching the show.
Mm-hmm.
And then like people tend to watch those because aside from like occasionally someone laughing or reacting to a scene, you can basically watch the episode on YouTube for free.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, so it's like one of those reaction videos.
Yeah. Well, apparently she did the 107 facts about Steven Universe. So like there's a video of her reacting to the whole 107 that I did. And
what?
I debated on recording my reaction to her reaction to my.
Whoa, then it's just going to come this endless.
Jesus
Christ. It'll be an endless loop. Like you'll do that and then she'll react to you reacting and then you can react to her reacting to you reacting to her.
When does it end?
It just never ends.
It'll just every 2 months, one of you will react to the other one and it'll go until the universe implodes.
Well, I mean, at least I had fun with mine. Like, did you regret yours, Dev?
No, I mean, like, for the most part, I didn't watch the whole thing. Like, I watched bits and pieces of it just to see. Like, I watched the beginning and noticed the changes. And I was like, all right. Because I don't really like my own voice. But there was a few parts where, like, I ad-libbed and they kept it. So that was cool.
Yeah.
But the 107 facts things are really neat for Frederator because, like, they're actually successful. Mm-hmm. Like, they cost nothing to produce and they get the most views. But like it also kind of saddens me because like when's the last time a cartoon actually aired on Cartoon Hangover?
Yeah, I mean, and I know they're done with two episodes of Bee and Puppy Cat, but they're but only the Kickstarter supporters can see it. Well,
they could have. They've taken it down.
Yeah, but I don't know when those are coming out because I know they're still working on Bravest Warriors season 3, I think. I don't know.
Mm-hmm. I guarantee that the Bee and Puppy Cat episodes will get released sometime. Like when the trailers for December come out, where the CPM spike really high,
mm-hmm.
I bet that's when they're going to release Bee and Puppy Cat.
Yeah.
I want to do a review of Bee and Puppy Cat because like I don't necessarily love it. Like I like the designs. I like the idea behind it. But like the series that we got from the Kickstarter is kind of not really super good.
Like, kind of not really good.
I love how you're just kind of like coding it and just kind of like trying to dance around.
It fucking sucks.
That's the nicest mean review I've ever heard. I mean, it's sort of not really good.
That's kind of how Tim was with Ren.
It's not bad. It's just not something I'd ever like or anyone ever would.
No, it's candy. The problem with I have with it is just candy.
Wait, what are you saying about candy?
Well, it tastes nice. It's fun to watch, but there's no substance. There's no like it's empty calories. It's just
no.
That's being Bubby Cat in a nutshell.
No, it's not candy. It's the candy that's stuck together at your grandma's candy bowl at her house. That's being Puppy Cat.
The first pilot makes it seem like it's going to have a story, but the rest were just slice of life episodes.
Well, that's my biggest issue is that there's like two things they brought up in the pilot and were. I've seen the episodes because I was a Kickstarter backer. And so we're like 3/4 done with the series. And we haven't touched upon either of those plot points of B having to grow up and be an adult to live in the world. And I guess the Puppy Cat is a Sailor Moon styled space prince. And yep. It seems to like the newest episode literally like brings it back up. And then she's like, "Nah, I'm not gonna be responsible." And just like, it's a big slap in the face for people who want actual character development.
I mean, was this the intention, like, to just make her lazy? And I guess that's the joke, something. I don't know.
I think that was them trying to like make it relatable, you know? Because we can all procrastinate and be lazy.
I mean, like, if you're going to have, like, so few episodes, like, you had to make them count. You can't just make slice-of-life filler episodes.
Mm-hmm. It does kind of feel like early Steven Universe.
Yeah, so maybe if we do, like, 10 more Kickstarters, we'll finally get somewhere on, like, the 20th episode.
I wouldn't mind, like, a half-an-hour movie, like a YouTube movie or something, where they just kind of touch upon what we actually wanted.
So like the Smosh movie?
I have not actually seen that. I put it on my Netflix like list to watch just because I know it's going to be bad, but I'm curious.
I saw it. The Smosh movie, you said?
Yeah.
I bought it. I own it. It's on my pile of DVDs right now.
Oh, my God. It's directed by Alex Winter, who is in Bill and Ted. I forget which one he was. Yeah, he's the one that's not Keanu Reeves.
Yeah, the blonde one.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think he also directed one of the Ben 10 live action movies.
I think so. He does like documentaries and kids stuff.
He directed both live action Ben 10 movies. And one of the Smosh writers, Steve Marmol, he did the good episodes of Danny Phantom. He was like the head writer.
Ooh.
So, yeah, How the Mighty Have Fallen.
Hey, they get a paycheck.
Yeah. Apparently, a random thing I found out is that the chick who plays Princess Leia, what's her name?
Carrie Fisher?
Yeah. Apparently, she's essentially a script editor. Like
she's a script doctor.
Yeah, and apparently we just don't credit those, and we apparently no longer pay them, so she stopped doing it. But
I read a bunch about this yesterday, but she, what a script doctor is, Patton Oswalt used to do it a lot for Pixar, and they have a room full of writers, and they come in and they ask jokes that you can kind of hear in the background or to punch up dialogue. And she got into it because when she was in the first Star Wars and that came out in 77, she didn't like some of Princess Leia's dialogue, so she would change it. And she was actually a script doctor on I think every Star Wars movie, but she also did I think it was Sister Act, what was the other one? Oh, Wedding Singer, like a bunch of random movies. But the reason a lot of people don't do script doctoring, who used to make a good living, and Carrie Fisher, by the way, is super rich because not only was she in Star Wars and was a successful script doctor, she also is Hollywood royalty because her parents were Eddie Fisher and Debbie Reynolds. So she's fine. But where is it going with this? Oh, so what they do now is they have you submit a bunch of ideas you have for the script, and they can use those ideas whether they hire you or not. So that's why a lot of people don't do it anymore, because you have to give them your ideas and they don't have to hire you. They can still use your ideas, which is crap. So,
yeah, that's fucked up.
Yeah. What a mess.
But she's cool. If you watch the interview of her on Good Morning America, it was like very funny. She's like a really cool person.
Yeah. Didn't she like start like abusing drugs when they were doing the Star Wars Christmas special?
That's what I've heard.
Well, I don't think that was limited to her, but if you watch the Star Wars Christmas special, but she was like doing coke. Like when they were on Hoth, she was doing as much snow as was probably on screen. She did a lot of coke.
If you notice in Empire Strikes Back, you can see her fingernails are all cut except for the one on her pinky. So,
is that true?
That's what people pointed out. Her pinky finger is the only nail that's not cut. So she was cutting coke with that.
Who would notice that? How do you notice that?
Someone,
really?
I think it was in Half in the Bag I was watching and they brought that up.
I mean, she has admitted on Empire she was on coke a lot. But it was also like that was the culture then. That wasn't like, and I'm not exaggerating it or joking, like you would be doing hair and makeup and there'd be a dish of cocaine there. Like that was like 70s Hollywood. So, and these were made at the end of the last one came out in 83. So it was kind of still normal to have that much cocaine around. So
yeah.
It's not like now where you have to put a little more effort into it. Then it was just like, oh, and here's, some donuts and some cocaine and some red vine licorice. And, it was like not
cocaine donuts.
You were that guy, weren't you?
No, I'm just saying because when you say donuts, I just imagine being those like, not so good powdered donuts that are really small.
Oh,
and then
no,
the same ones, but it's coke instead of powder.
I was imagining you were the guy who's like, I know what to do. And you grab a donut and put it in the dish of cocaine and then eat it. And you go, yes.
But yeah, how about next news report? Because we trailed off so bad. Lauren Faust is no longer working on Sony Pictures Animation's Medusa movie due to creative differences.
Ooh.
Next news. Hey, you like the
good... Was she the director? What was she?
Oh, she was the director for Medusa, the movie.
So who's directing it now?
I don't know. No one cool.
Good luck with that, Sony.
Honestly, who really cares? Who cares about Medusa? No one.
Well, I think it's more the interesting point for that story is less of Lauren Foss or Medusa, but more of just like Sony just doesn't seem to be keeping creators around very often. Because I know another another news article that we're going to be talking about involves Sony as well.
Yeah.
Kind of. So it's just like, Sony, what the fuck are you doing?
Yeah, well, might as well bring up this news report. Samurai Jack is returning to Adult Swim for new episodes, and Genndy Tartakovsky, the original creator, is back on it.
Cool.
So yeah, I guess it's a good thing that Popeye movie fell through.
I thought he was an executive producer.
Oh, well, I don't know. Well, he's working on something.
That's a good Japan.
I don't know. He's involved in some form, so, you know, that's good, I guess. Whatever.
He's involved enough that they put in the advertisement, the original creators back, you know, with the show.
Yeah.
Which is super exciting.
Yeah. It took like 10, 20 years, but finally back.
Well,
20 years.
Close enough. I tried.
It's been 84 years.
I can't believe Steven Universe premiered 80 years ago.
Yeah, it doesn't really list on the Wikipedia. It only lists the only person listed creatively is Tarkovsky as executive producer. So I'm wondering who's directing.
That's one thing I'm really worried about, like who's the talent behind it? Who's going to be heading the show? Who's going to be, like, making everything? And it's like, is it going to be animated in fucking Flash?
Nah, I mean, it's a Cartoon Network Studios production, they say, so, you know. But it's going to air on Adult Swim's Toonami block.
So a lot of people seem really excited about the fact that it's going to be on Adult Swim. That means there's less regulations or whatever. I'm just kind of scared that it's going to not be the same show, and they're going to try and, like, now that we're on Adult Swim, we're at night, let's make it super gritty. No more robots, let's make it humans.
Nah.
And it's just like, I don't know, like, it could be cool, but I'm super sick of this whole everything has to be dark and gritty, and, you know, that's the only way you can tell a good story that's action anymore.
I mean,
that's true.
If anything, I'm sure they'll have at least a PG rating. It's not going to go up that bad.
I don't know.
I mean, it's
honestly
still connected to a kid's show, and they want to, like, air this overseas, likely, since, well, it's animation. They're going to air it overseas anyway, so I'm sure it's going to be just a PG rating.
I want, like, a curse word or two. That's it. Like,
darn.
Just shit.
No, they can only say darn.
I mean, it shows how much Cartoon Network's changed, that they wouldn't let an action show come back on regular just Cartoon Network, and they're putting out an Adult Swim instead.
Well, Toonami was the action block for Cartoon Network, so, like,
that's true,
I think it's fitting.
Is it on Toonami, or I thought it was just on Adult Swim?
Yeah. I guess to get some original audience.
Ratings.
Oh, it is on. Okay, sorry, I missed that.
I mean, I guess it fits better with all the other action shows, since they have no action blocks themselves on Cartoon Network's channel. Just the...
Well, it's probably... Well, sorry, what were you going to say? Oh, well, it's probably also because the people who are nostalgic for Samurai Jack are watching Adult Swim. They're not really watching regular Cartoon Network as much, maybe. Which, I don't know if that makes sense, but maybe that's part of the reason they did it that way.
Well, I'm going to assume that Cartoon Network, with its slapstick comedy with, like, Teen Titans Go and stuff like that, probably skews a lot younger in the demographic than it has in the last few years, aside from the occasional regular show, Venture Time, and Steven Universe.
Kids still like that a lot, though. Mm-hmm. So, but yeah, I guess that's true, because they don't really... They used to skew all over the place when Samurai Jack was there, because, like, Powerpuff Girls and Dexter had wider demos than they currently do. Because a lot... I feel like Teen Titans, and I can't remember every show on there, but it does feel like even Gumball, I don't know many adults that even watch Gumball.
So. Gumball's great from an animation standpoint. Like, it's just really cool to see all the art styles.
I mean, I like Gumball a lot. I don't think enough people... I don't know. Gumball makes me laugh.
I just feel like Cartoon Network is still just kind of like in a period where they're recovering from CN Real.
Yeah.
That's well behind them by now.
Definitely, yeah, but I mean, like, that kind of did a dent to him for sure, and people are just like, eh, Cartoon Network's not what it used to be, and they probably won't watch it ever again, so.
Yeah. I mean, everyone a lot of the creators left Cartoon Network after that. That's like the whole, it kind of reminds me of now with the Konami's and Hideo Kojima thing.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Oh, well, the Kojima thing is a lot different. Because they weren't actively spiting their creators. They were just like, we're going in a completely different direction. Because with Konami, there's like some fucking ill will, because they like banned Kojima from accepting an award. So, yeah, it's similar, yeah, but that situation is a lot more messed up and a lot more petty politics.
Mm-hmm. So I know I've seen a lot of people like worried about Samurai Jack, not from your guys' standpoint, but like Mako is no longer a voice actor because he passed away. So like, what are they gonna do with Aku? But the cool thing is that like Aku had a stand-in who appeared in a lot of the episodes from the original show and any like other media. So like, he's safe. You won't even notice there's a difference. That's how good his stand-in is.
I was gonna say, yeah, Mako's not a voice actor anymore, and I was gonna be like, cause he's fucking dead.
I mean, who is Will Gendy be more involved? Because the movie, whatever the movie he's working on, this original movie, he even said in that interview, what was it like 2 months ago, that wasn't greenlit yet. So is he setting this up so he has another project to jump to? Because he knows that's not going to happen.
I know that like he definitely wants to work on something on his own. Because for anyone that's not in the know, he was working on a Popeye cartoon where it was like super true to form. It's essentially what Peanuts movie was for Peanuts. It would have been for Popeye. And like it's going great. People loved it. I know a lot of people were super excited. And then Sony's like, yeah, that's not the direction I want to go in. So it's not canceled. It's just Genndy Tartakovsky's removed from the project. Like there might
no one else has taken it off, taken over it, I don't think.
Right, but I think they're still interested in making it.
Oh, I know that during the Sony hack, the emails that leaked about Sony Animation was basically like, we should probably do this because Genndy's been a good sport during the Hotel Transylvania movies. Like he was always like, he'd take all the notes from Adam Sandler and Robert Smigel and he didn't fight it. And I think it seemed like, I don't remember, it was like a year ago that I read these emails, but it felt like there was this feeling inside Sony that they know they're not doing right by him. So maybe if this project does get made, they'll give him a little more free rein, or if he leaves, they're just going to let him go and do what he wants. So I still don't understand, why is he not at Pixar? Like, why did Pixar not pick him up? That's bothered me forever.
Well, because in that like interview, he specified that he really wants to work on his own stuff again. Like that's what he really truly enjoys. And there was also a lot of talk. Like this is definitely Samurai Jack's been in the works for a little bit, because he mentioned like, yeah, I have a really good feeling it's coming back. Like he hinted at it. And you know, at that time, Samurai Jack's been dead for 12 years. No one's really going to be like thinking about it. So yeah, I didn't think a thing of it. And then here it is. It's back. And in that same interview, he talked about how Samurai Jack never actually got canceled. Like, the Symbionic Titans, the first show that got canceled on him, like all the other shows he's worked on, it's been like a mutual agreement between him and Cartoon Network being like, I think it's time for us to stop. Or Samurai Jack, he was like, hey, they wanted him to work on Clone High. And he was like, all right, we'll just take a break from Samurai Jack. And then he just never came back to it.
Clone High?
Clone Wars.
Okay.
Wars. Yeah. Oh. Yeah, for a second I was like, what? Did I miss something?
Okay. No, I'm just dumb.
But
yeah, so Samurai Jack was just, they ordered like, I think, 52 episodes and they were done. Like, he didn't really cancel. He just wanted to work on other things.
I'm just curious where he's going to go. Like, what is exactly his next project that he's directing? Because he could, like, I don't know. I also don't get, like, DreamWorks doesn't really have that many big directors. Like, they could buy him up and it would probably help them out tremendously.
Yeah. But you don't,
they haven't been doing so. What?
You know, the people behind the scenes, DreamWorks seems more about the characters and voice actors is all I hear anyone ever talk about.
That's, well, they let the guy who does the How to Train Your Dragon movies, I feel like they let him alone. The guy who did the first, I think it was like Dean Deblin and then Chris Sanders, they let those guys kind of do what they want. But it feels like everybody else is just kind of like a studio director. They're not considered, they're not given the free rein. They don't have an auteur studio like Pixar.
Right. So,
but I don't know. I just don't get, like, Gendy's like one of the best animators of our generation, and it feels like he doesn't get treated that way, which is super annoying. It's like, why? I don't know. Maybe they have had meetings with him and he's like not interested and, you know, I'm just blowing smoke, but I don't know. It's something I think about, at least.
I'm expecting, like, maybe he'll go to, like, Real FX with Jorge Gutierrez because they're a lower budget studio, but they kind of take more risks with certain things.
Yeah.
Like a Book of Life.
Character design wise, yeah. And he'd have fun over there, probably. He should.
Yeah, that'd be
Book of Life was fun. It wasn't a good movie.
How
but
fucking
it was visually
dare
cool.
you?
How dare you take away Pan's only representation ever in animation?
Yeah.
You come to his house.
What the fuck? I let you in this Skype call and you do this? Fuck off.
It's visually one of my favorite movies. I love looking at it. I just didn't like how it was presented, like, in terms of story. The whole book element, I know that's what it's named after, but the whole, like, cutting back to the kids, there was no real, like, point to it. Like, if you compare it to, like, Princess Bride, where they kept cutting back to the two characters reading the book, and it actually added to the story. With Book of Life, it was just like, hey, we're kids, here's a joke, all right, let's go back to the story. It didn't add suspense, it didn't add to those characters, it was a mess.
Oh.
Ay, caramba.
I'm sorry, Pan. So, I didn't mean to offend.
Want to go to the next news article?
I'm sorry, Pan.
You sound so sad, Pan. You're just
I'm
like,
sorry.
My heritage has been shat
hey,
on.
The good dinosaur is the...
Wait.
Oh, what?
I want to say one more thing about Samurai Jack. So, like, I'm friends with a couple of people that work at Cartoon Network, and... TV Kyle, who does the Mighty Madge store or Magic Stores.
Oh yeah, we try to get him on the podcast, but he hasn't responded yet.
Oh, it sucks. He's pretty cool. He was on Joe Goes on, like, the Power Ranger episode. But anyways, he, like, posted on Facebook. He was like, "I work here," and I didn't even know. I was like, "That's hilarious."
It was really kept under wraps.
Yeah.
Production actually, like, started on it or no?
I mean, it's at least, like, been a thing for 2 months, because, like I said, Guinea, like, hinted at it at that Cartoon Brew interview.
Yeah.
And 2016's a really quick time, like, turnaround. Don't most cartoons take at least 2 or 3 years of production?
Well, I mean, unless they're going to, like, just get all the old model sheets and whatever from the past series and just work off that.
Storyboarding. Do they know when in 2016 it is?
Even if it's December, a year, like, if they start it now and plan on airing, that's a really rushed production.
That's
depending
true.
On how many episodes. Like, is this actually, like, a new season, or is this going to be like a five, you know, like, they just air one episode a day, like Over the Garden Wall or something?
Who knows?
Or is it 15-minute episodes?
Yeah, I'm sure it's going to be 30 minutes because it's on Toonami. Like, otherwise, there's not going to be time for anything.
Yeah, I'm just really curious because, like, that's what really matters. If it's, like, 5 episodes, I can see it being done. But if it's a whole season, there's no way, you know?
Who knows? Mm-hmm. Pixar's movie, The Good Dinosaur, is the lowest box office number opening for a Pixar movie ever.
Oh, it's actually...
Yeah.
If the box office estimates for this weekend, it was number 4 in its second week.
Yeah. So, why do you think this movie is such a gigantic fucking failure that Pixar is in shame?
Well, I don't know if it's a failure, but I will say I didn't get to see it on Thanksgiving. I saw it, like, the Monday after. I saw both that and Creed. And although it was a Monday afternoon, which... isn't the biggest time at the box office, The Good Dinosaur had 5 people in the theater and Creed was packed. So I think it's a lot to do with this is kind of a weird time because the studios are, like, worried about Star Wars. So they're not releasing too much, and people are also, like, don't want to go to the movies yet, also because of Star Wars. And since Creed has a lot of word of mouth, people will go out to that because they're like, oh, cool, it's a cool Rocky movie. I know they're different demos. I'm not, but I'm using them as a comparison to say Good Dinosaur doesn't have great word of mouth. And the reason I knew a lot of people would see Inside Out is because not just because it's a Pixar movie, but because it's a Pixar movie that got great reviews and everybody said was incredible. And if you have a Pixar movie without that great word of mouth, I don't think it's going to do as well because people are so kind of weird about animation. You're getting like the family audiences, but you're not getting the kind of summer Pixar stuff. So I actually also think it should have been put out a year from now, the same year as Finding Dory, not Inside Out. Because Inside Out, I feel like, has completely overpowered it in most people's minds.
Well, I mean, The Good Dinosaur just doesn't look interesting. I mean, we had The Croods, we've had Dinosaur. I feel like we've had movies similar to it, and I haven't seen the movie, so there's some like hidden thing that marketing didn't show to make it outstanding. But for what it sounds, what the preview showed, there's nothing super appealing about it.
I mean, it is too modest. I think it's a very modest, small pan. Did you see it? Or?
Oh, no. But let me just say that they say it's the lowest performing for any Pixar movie, adjusted for inflation. And it made $39 million opening. Inside Out made $90 million, three times The Good Dinosaur.
But that was also Good Dinosaur made the same amount as A Bug's Life.
Yeah, but that was a forever ago. Yeah.
I mean, that's adjusted. It has probably the lowest attend. It has definitely the lowest attendance for an opening Pixar.
Yeah,
but it wasn't the greatest time. And I think the Peanuts movie is still performing well. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's in its fifth week, and I have the box office open right, or the estimate box office for this weekend, and it's still number 7. And that probably hurts it. But I just think that a big reason Pixar movies make so much more than any other studio is because I know so many people who won't see it right when it comes out, but they'll see it a month or 2 months later because they keep hearing how great it is. And without that, I think Pixar is seeing kind of probably, oddly enough, part of their sales pitch is how good they are. That's why they make so much money. And without that, this is making like what did Penguins of Madagascar make last Thanksgiving? I bet it's pretty similar.
Ouch.
So, but it fell 60%, which is pretty bad. I mean, that's harsh. I mean, and
maybe it's the competition, I guess. That's what I'm thinking.
Well, yeah. Is this the first Pixar movie to air 2 Pixar movies in 1 year?
Yeah.
Yes, it is.
So it might be just people... people are stupid, so like they probably think it's not a Pixar movie, but a Disney movie. I mean, it's really hard to tell the difference between them sometimes. But like, I don't know. Maybe people were like, "Oh, you already saw the Pixar movie, Inside Out."
Yeah. I know one of the things I read about with Star Wars coming out is that Disney has a lot of power with all the multiplexes right now. I mean, they always do, but like this month especially. And apparently what they're going to do is going to request they don't get rid of Good Dinosaur in a lot of screens if they want to have Star Wars. So what might happen is Good Dinosaur just stays around. And since what happens when a movie, like remember when Avatar happened and Sherlock Holmes did like crazy business and even the Squeakquel did really well. And it's because when Avatar was sold out, people are like, well, let's see this instead. Or they go to the theater for the first time in forever and they're like, what's that? Maybe I'll see that. And it had with Titanic, the same thing happened. And I think Disney, I've read on Deadline Hollywood and other places, they're kind of hoping that if they keep the Good Dinosaur around till Christmas, then the halo effect will work on Good Dinosaur and it'll kind of work out for them. But that's not a great strategy, frankly. You know, I think it's the film's too modest and they're a studio that just looks like they came back from sequeldom, and I don't think it was the right move.
Yeah, I mean, like in the trailers it says, well, their whole pitch is, what if the meteor that struck the dinosaurs didn't kill them? And the trailer really doesn't explain anything. It asks that question. It's like, it looks like any other dinosaur TV show with humans there.
It is kind of, that's kind of the problem with dinosaur kids films is they all try to do the Land Before Time plot. Like, that was the problem with Dinosaur, the 2000 movie, as well.
Which
that
one also reviewed earlier this the week, right?
But that, yeah. But it was, the problem with that one ripped it off hardcore. Like, they even have, it's not called the Great Valley, it's like the Great Green Place or something. It's like
the Hidden Valley Ranch.
It's the Hidden Valley. Yeah. The Hidden Valley. It's just, it's pretty, if
just
you watch
this Great Green Place, I just like the name of that. It's just so plain.
Actually, and the worst thing about Dinosaur is they knew it was ripping off Land Before Time, like in production, but then they went and they wanted to have the dinosaurs not have voices, which was also an idea Land Before Time wanted to do, but both times were like, that's not commercial, so we have to put the voices in. So with Dinosaur, they actually knew they were ripping off Land Before Time, but they couldn't stop it. But this, it gets close to that, but they do interesting stuff with it, but I think it's not unique enough. Like, Pixar, I think if Good Dinosaur was a DreamWorks movie, I would put it higher. You know, it would be high up there. Whereas Pixar's got too many big films. It's just like, it's kind of doomed because of their success, which is just too outstanding. So I still think
this movie would have done better if it was released like the third Pixar movie, or, you know, like earlier on when they were still finding themselves.
I mean, maybe, but also like Bug's Life, when I kind of like Bug's Life, and I know a lot of people who don't like that one that much. So I think it's kind of in that realm where it's just, or Disney movies like Aristocats or Sword in the Stone, where they get like kind of the single disc treatment. And there's a lot of people who don't like those movies. And to me, they're great. But I think more people like the outstanding classics, and the middle of the road kind of stuff in a filmography, people go, eh. And if they don't have anything personal attached to it, I think they're not as into it, really. But it's still, I mean, it's not a bad movie. It is a good movie. It's just not an outstanding success, you know. So
the reason why I asked that is because, like, if you look at any of the special features where, like, they show, like, behind the scenes of Pixar's, like, studio, The Good Dinosaur has been in production for a long time.
No, it had a troubled production. It completely changed the script.
Yeah, like, watch 107 Facts About The Good Dinosaur. Like, they go over all these script changes, and, like, it was going to be released 2013, but they delayed it for 2 years and completely reworked the thing.
I mean, I don't know what it was. Apparently, they've even said it wasn't, like, a horrible movie. It was still a decent movie, but they thought it could have been better, which is, like, so what was it? Like, they completely fired the director, but the same thing happened to Ratatouille, mind you.
Mm-hmm. And, well, I think the last set of Pixar movies, they all have had the director, like, get removed midway through production. Brave. Well,
except for Inside Out, I think all of them have, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because that's, well, I've noticed if you were one of the core directors who started with them, they will support you no matter what. And if you're anybody else, you're just an employee, you know? It's like, because Stanton, Brad Bird, and Pete Docter and Lasseter can do whatever they want, and everyone else kind of has to just deal with it. And I think it seemed to me they were really promoting Peter Sohn, who directed Good Dinosaur, and they want another auteur because of that's kind of how Ghibli fell apart, is they didn't have anyone to take the reins.
Yeah.
Because who's that guy who did that one movie and then he died from exhaustion from working too much? So it sounds like a great place to work. If because I forget his name. He did Whisper of the Heart. I'm butchering this. But they are probably aware that they need someone else to come in and be an auteur, or they're just going to become any other studio.
That's why Miyazaki keeps trying to leave. It's like, I need to get out before it takes me.
I mean, that's pretty much – no, that actually is – he calmed down a lot after Mononoke, because that guy died working on Mononoke. Or shortly after, and they said he had a heart condition from being too stressed out from working at Studio Ghibli.
Damn.
I mean, he was, and his movie was, now I forget the name of his movie, god damn it, but it was cool, and he was considered the successor, and then he died, and they never really found someone to replace him. So I think Pixar is aware they need someone, but they haven't. The Good Dinosaur doesn't show me they found someone, you know.
Yeah,
so.
I remember seeing this one, like, Ghibli thing where it's like Miyazaki making ramen for everybody. I just like to think that's just his way of being like, hey, guys, let's chill out. Let's just relax a little bit, you know.
That was the first time they ate.
Died.
That was the first time they ate that week.
Yeah.
It was like, no food until you get this in-between. Perfect. it was a Whisper of the Heart. The guy who directed that, he's the one who died. He was supposed to be the successor, and he only did one movie. But yeah.
But also, I mean, if you really stop and think about it, Pixar has been on top for so long that, like, you can't always be the best, you know? Like, there's going to be a few movies that aren't great and or don't perform super well. And the thing that sucks is, like, when you're used to being the top, even, you know, Good Dinosaur could be a great movie, and it's obviously not doing the worst ever, you know? It still made millions of dollars, but it seems like a failure and less of a success. I mean, it is less of a success, but it's nowhere near a failure. Unless you're on the top, you know. Yeah.
But, you know, one thing that really bugs me is that the whole plot of what if the meteor that was supposed to kill the dinosaurs didn't? That's the same plot of the Super Mario Brothers movie.
Oh, you're right.
What the fuck? They ripped off my movie. I was Luigi in that film.
Goodbye, dinosaurs. What if the dinosaurs weren't all destroyed? What if the impact of that meteorite created a parallel dimension where the dinosaurs continue to thrive and evolve into intelligent, vicious, aggressive beings? Just like us. And hey, what if they found a way back?
People complained a lot about that setup because it doesn't really play into the movie, and we're comparing it to Cars, but I don't know. A lot of their plots are weird. Like, you know, monsters living in a society that uses energy based on kids' screams is a little weird, too.
It's a fucked up concept, yeah.
I mean, they always have weird concepts. So I kind of, it's just the idea that, I'm not spoiling anything, but that the idea that Arlo and his family are farmers and the dinosaurs evolved and became, like, different than what we understand as dinosaurs. So that's why Arlo can talk and... it's slightly like a Western and stuff because, like, they evolved. And I don't know when in this alternate history it's supposed to take place. But it's an interesting idea. But, you know, I don't know. I still think I will see any Pixar. So I still saw it, you mm-hmm. know.
But out of curiosity, because you did see the movie, right?
Yeah.
How did you feel about the super cartoony dinosaurs and character models with the overly realistic backgrounds?
It worked really well, I thought. I mean, I didn't have a problem with it. I also had seen the Disney's Dinosaur right before, so maybe the...
that helped.
Yeah, that probably helped a lot. I thought it worked better than... Well, in Dinosaur, when they did it, it was an interesting idea that didn't work great, but they didn't get to have someone go out there with a camera and shoot it. Those were all done in computers, I believe. So I think it worked better because they could get the lighting to work. And I don't know, color wise, I didn't have any problem with it. It looked great, though. It looked beautiful, like an old Hollywood Western or something.
Kind of reminds me. Oh, go on.
No, you go for it. It's your podcast, man.
Yeah, it kind of reminds me of like, I think last year there was a movie called Walking with Dinosaurs, and it was pretty much.
Yeah,
Dinosaur 2000, but I think originally it was just a silent movie, but they dubbed over it, even though the characters had no mouth movements, so it just looked very disconnecting.
So it was like Homeward Bound?
I think so. Yeah, I guess so. Is that the dog movie?
With
the
dog and a cat and another dog?
Did we all see both Homeward Bound movies?
I think I saw one. I don't know if I saw two.
Forever ago in like a classroom.
Yeah, as a kid, I saw the sequel, the second one, and I loved it more than the first one. I need to go back as an adult where my palate's a little bit better, and I'll probably enjoy the first one being a better movie. Like, that's just usually how it goes. But I like the second one a lot.
When you're a kid, you like sequels for, like, you're like, I don't know, it was more fun. And
yeah.
Like, I liked Conan. I used to really like Conan the Destroyer when I was, like, 8. And now I can't even sit through that. I'm like, what was wrong with me? And I was like, I know, because it wasn't as serious and dark as Conan the Barbarian. And it was more like a kid's movie. So, of course, I like Conan the Destroyer.
I didn't have that same mindset because I always knew for some reason the sequels were not as good. Like Shrek 2, I was like, this isn't as good as the first.
You
You do not say.
No, that. I was 10. I was stupid. I didn't know what I was thinking.
Shrek 2 is the better of the two movies.
Yeah, I haven't watched Shrek 2 in forever.
I love Shrek 2. I could watch that anytime, anywhere. Like, I as a kid, I watched it nonstop. I think the first one's a little bit, like, they're both good movies for the most part. But, like, I don't know. I thought Shrek 2 was just the more enjoyable of the two.
Actually, I have a good Shrek 2 theater story. It's like a Sophie's Choice, almost. I came to the theater, and we're at the beach, and they were like, we're like looking at what's playing, and the person said, well, look, here's the options for right now. If you want to see a movie right now, you can either see Troy with air conditioning or Shrek 2 without. And we picked Troy, which I felt was a mistake. Because what, I mean, what would you pick? Troy with air conditioning or Shrek 2 without? Oh. It's tough.
Shrek 2 without.
Shrek 2 without.
How hot is it that day?
It was pretty. It was pretty hot. It was like, but then Troy was like awful. The only good part is the part in the trailer where Brad Pitt takes a sword and he like jams it through some guy's neck, and the rest was like, so bad.
I didn't see Troy, but I do distinctly remember the trailer when my classroom, we took a field trip. I think we went to see the movie Radio or some baseball movie.
But you got to go to really cool field trips. You just went to the movies? That's an awesome school you went to.
We were elementary. It was elementary school, and I think it was like one of those after tax day, well, after task test or whatever the test was, like the final test of the year.
After SATs. Which.
No, this was elementary school. There were no SATs for elementary school.
Wait, what?
What?
You had no SATs for after elementary school? What the fuck?
No, during elementary school.
No, you didn't have any during elementary school.
Wait, people take the SATs in elementary school?
I did.
What?
I'm pretty sure. I assumed it was like all the time.
I thought
like
it was just all through school.
No, definitely high school. That's a fact. Maybe middle school and elementary.
What they special needs school did I go to?
Oh, well, you saw movies.
No.
Wait, Nolan, didn't you go to like a genius school?
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Oh,
I completely forgot.
Okay.
I mean, you always forget that time Nolan went to Harvard and then became a teenage doctor in Nolan Hauser.
Fucked it up.
Sorry.
Fucked it up. It's over.
But since we're talking about Doogie Howser, or I am, and you're listening to me, do you remember the Doogie Howser where he goes on a date with a girl and she has something wrong with her appendix and they're like, we need to operate and you're the only doctor here? And he's like, but I haven't seen her naked yet.
I think I remember that.
Dude, he's about to fucking score, man.
That was like my favorite. I was like, yeah, I was like, don't worry, she'll be passed out. And he goes, everyone leave the room.
Oh, that's so uncomfortable. So weird.
I think I remember that. They were playing this on the Hub channel when the Hub channel was a thing.
It was a cool show because he'd always have ones where he'd date some girl and she'd have an appendix or something.
Doogie Howser was a little kid, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, and he'd always have to operate. Maybe that only happened once. I don't remember the
Young
show.
Young Neil though. Patrick Harris when he was a kid, a child star.
Yeah.
So if we're segueing just for the word doctor, does anyone in here watch Doctor Who?
No.
Yes, oh, I haven't seen. I don't want to. Season 4.
I don't want to talk about it. I haven't watched that one yet.
Okay.
No
fine.
One didn't. You sent me some stupid animation, and I was like, I'm not watching this shit.
Oh, the Dreamland.
Oh my god!
One?
Yeah, I sent you the Infinite Quest.
What was that?
It was an official Doctor Who like animated. It was commissioned by BBC, and it's the worst looking thing I've ever seen.
There's another one called Dreamland, and it's CG. And it takes place at Roswell, and it's so ugly.
I remember there was this fan animation of Doctor Who. It was of like
anime Doctor Who.
Yeah, it looked awesome, like an 80s cyberpunk anime.
I have it in my favorites if you want me to link it.
Just take a quick look around. I must say, this is almost impressive.
Yeah. I'll link that in the description, the 80s cyberpunk Doctor Who. That, like, it's fan-made, but I wish that was real. I want to watch, I need to watch some 80s cyberpunk animes like that.
Well, man, okay, the current Doctor Who just frustrates me because I really liked season 3, and, like, I feel like the show has peaked ever since of the new Who.
Well, I didn't like, I haven't seen, I'm not up to date, but the found footage one they did was so beyond frustrating. No, the reason that didn't work is that narrating guy just every time they get to something goes, and then this happened. I was like, oh, fuck you. You're just like, I couldn't even.
Found footage episode?
Yeah, they did a found footage episode recently.
They tried to do it, but it was by someone who like didn't know how found footage worked. And it's like, that's one of the worst things about horror is that there are actual rules to that genre. So when someone who doesn't get that genre, like horror, tries to step into it, they usually are stepping in it, and we have to watch them wipe it off their shoe for the whole movie. It's like that's why like Romero and Carpenter and stuff are like considered greats, because they get the rules and know how to play with them. And when you get someone who doesn't and then comes into it, it's usually awful, because they're like, no, it'll be atmospheric. And you're like, oh, you mean bad?
Well, because something I wanted to talk about regarding Doctor Who, and this kind of relates to everything, is TV shows now, we know how many episodes a person's going to be in it. We know way too much through press releases, because we're always hungry for information. And so, like, if a new season of a show comes out, they'll go ahead and tell us that, like, oh, show-and-show is going to guest appear in 5 episodes. And so, like, we knew how many episodes the current companion was going to be in, so it's kind of easy to figure out when she's going to get written off. But she won't go away.
That is the problem with Doctor Who, because the old show, the former show before the one that's going on currently, each story, you never knew how long it was going to be. Like, you'd look at, like, the one episode would be an hour and a half, and the next one would be 3 hours or 2.5 hours. And the thing I hate about the new one is they're all an hour long. And I kind of like in the new season, they do a lot of two-parters and stuff, which has worked out really well for them. But, like, I don't understand. The weirdest thing is that we have Netflix, we have Hulu. We actually don't really need time slots anymore. Why do we have? We don't have a show that's like that, that has a different length each time? Because we could feasibly do it with everything we have now. And why isn't Doctor Who like on Hulu or something? And it's like the old days, and we get one that's an hour and one that's an hour and a half. But it's become incredibly predictable, whereas the old show, you never knew what you're getting into. And I thought that was a lot more fun.
Some of the online shows that are streaming, like Hulu Originals or like Community, for example, Community episode from season 6 ranged from anywhere from like 25 minutes to like, I think one was like 35 or something. Like,
I didn't realize that.
Yeah. So online streaming, they do that. It's never like, from an hour to 3 hours, but there's usually like a 10-minute gap of like where it can end.
Uh-huh.
But like my biggest issue with the current season, like the last 3 episodes, is just like the Doctor Who has this habit of like they can't just leave the companion. Like they have to become the most important thing to the show.
Yeah.
And it can't just be like, hey, I don't want to, like, maybe we should stop, traveling together. All right, they'll make me sad. I'm going to miss you. But no, I mean, like, I've been doing this for a while. It's dangerous. I need to live my life. It can never be just that. It always has to be like, well, something happened with the time vortex and we can never go back to where they're at. They are trapped. Oh, yeah.
The Amy Pond thing was like, they just don't know. They used to just leave companions places to be like, no, just get that pizza over there. No, it's over there. I'll be right, but just over there. And then they're like, let's get in the TARDIS. Get the fuck out. Just leave them on planet. Who's a what's it? In the planet was, and everyone has to deal with it.
And so, like, not to spoil too much for you, Jim, but, like, Clara leaves, and they spend 3 episodes going back and ending her resolution for us.
Yeah, that's...
And I want her to be gone.
What the frick, bro?
I just want her to be gone, and they just keep coming back.
I mean, they're just gonna keep... I don't know. That show has gotten better, but they still have the problem like having him monologue about how great humanity is every 2 episodes. It's like always been a problem for me.
My friend Dan, I was talking to him like a night or two ago, and he was ranting about how much he fucking hates Doctor Who now because of the Moffat run.
Yeah,
like how much it fucking ruined Doctor Who.
Well, it's fan fiction.
Yeah, that's
the biggest issue with Doctor Who right now is ever since the current showrunner has jumped on, all of it has just became like this giant fan fiction-y sounding, like the Doctor's companion. They have sex, and then they have a baby, and that baby grows up and becomes the Doctor's wife. Isn't that Twilight?
What the fuck?
No, they don't have... He doesn't have sex with...
No. But the companion boyfriend have sex, and then they have a baby, and the baby grows up become his wife, and it's...
River Song's my least favorite character.
She was great for the first episode.
I don't like her. I just don't.
Friend Dan feels the exact same way, Jim. He hates... oh, by the way, I guess we should say spoilers. But fucking too late for that. Anyway, I liked River Song in her first episode, too. And then my friend Dan explained everything to me about what happens to her. And I'm like, oh, that does sound bad.
And then she turns into some black lady for a little bit. That was just... I was thinking about this because I watched the original Star Wars, and then while I was watching, I was having a hard time not thinking about how I know all this stuff from the prequels, and like there's a part where they talk about how the Empire finally took out.
Hello.
Mine got cut off, and I couldn't hear that. But I'm assuming you're talking about the line where Luke goes, "You fought in the Clone Wars."
Oh no, I was talking about. There's a line with Darth Vader, and they talk about how the Emperor finally took down the Senate, which is in the prequels how they vote for all this bizarre, dumb stuff. And when I was a kid watching the original, I'd always be like, what's the Senate? That must be something. And now that I know, I'm like, oh, that's way less interesting. Thanks a lot, George Lucas.
Yeah. I guess sometimes it's more interesting to not go over the backstory and let it settle in your mind, and you think of something more interesting.
Yeah, it's kind of like, I think somebody talked about it, I don't know who or what, but it's always like that the imagination or the mystery behind everything is just kind of like usually better than the explanation you give.
Actually, that's, are we still doing Over the Garden Wall or no?
Fuck it, who cares?
No, okay, well, this has a little relate to it, so I'll just like bring it up a little bit, but... One of the things I like about Over the Garden Wall is you never know if they're in the afterlife, if it's some weird dimension you can only get to from being unconscious, like what the deal is with it. And for most of Over the Garden Wall, you don't know why they're like how they got there, why they can talk like modern people, what the deal is with this thing. And it totally works because when it reveals in the last two parts what's going on, it's like it's like very smartly constructed. And there's a mystery to it. Like, you still don't know, like, what Potter's Field is exactly. Like, why are these frog people have a society with a rowboat? Not a rowboat. What are those boats called? Whatever. Steamboat. It's on a, what?
Steamboat?
Steamboat. Yeah, it's like you don't know any, you don't understand. But I've watched that whole thing, like, maybe two or three times. And there's still a lot of mystery to it. And I don't want an Over the Garden Wall, like, explaining the universe or anything like that. And
it's perfect how it is.
Yeah, it's like wonderful. Like if you watch the pilot, they're originally going to make it like an Adventure Time kind of thing, which wouldn't have worked. I really like when there's mystery to something. And I think when we try to explain things, it's like what happens with every horror movie villain is in the first one, they're mysterious and cool. And then we keep making sequels and explaining their backstory. And by part seven, you're like, oh, Michael Myers is here. That's cool. I guess. I know he's Laurie Strode's brother, and that's their other sister, and that's that guy's related to them this way. And some horror fans love that, but it's like why most people don't watch part seven is because it's just so boring narratively. It's like
plus part of the experience is talking with people and leaving things up to interpretation. Like in Over the Garden Wall, the frogs and Steamboat is represented by like at the intro, there's like two kids playing with the steamboat and there's like a frog in the background. And that like kind of represents what that means in real life, but it's interpreted enough to where like that's what I'm assuming. And I don't need to know for sure.
I mean, the most recent time I've watched both that and the original Star Wars, I thought about, like, you know what? I don't want to live in this world where I know. I just want to be, like, in this mystery, you know, live in the mystery of it. Like, how much... I mean, with Over the Garden Wall, I can do that a lot better than Star Wars. But it's like, I don't want to think about how it's purgatory. Like, I like the way it is not knowing, or, like, you know... I think that's a better... Sometimes I like the mystery of it. The ambiguity is a lot more fun.
Or how do you feel about, like, movie... Like, for example, Indiana Jones. The fourth movie is awful for multiple reasons, but I think the biggest issue is that Indiana Jones works as a young hero. And then seeing him old, I don't need that.
I don't think the reason that one didn't work is because each Indiana Jones movie is based on a particular type of movie or literature. Like, mm-hmm. Raiders is based on pulp comics. Temple of Doom is based on kind of B-movies. I forget. Last Crusade, I honestly forget. And they're trying to do, like, I think Temple of Doom was 40s adventure B-movies. And they're trying to do just B drive-in movies for Crystal Skull. And it, like, you can't, I don't see that at all in that movie. Like, it's just not there. And the problem with Indiana Jones is they don't have that theory. They also don't have the guy who shot the first three Indiana Jones. And that's a huge problem. And if watch Crystal Skull and watch... Well, don't watch Crystal Skull. Don't do that. But, like, watch one of the first three and you'll see how beautiful it is. And the problem with a lot of movies is there's a theory behind them. And when you just go, well, we have to do this for business. And I understand film doesn't exist in my weird theory world. But, like, when you take that theory away, it doesn't work as well. And you need that theory. You know,
no,
it's why it makes sense. And I think that's to me why it doesn't work. It's not just because he's young. Like, if they had a good enough theory and he was defeating, like, they made it work in a B movie way in the 50s. It would have been awesome, but, you know, I don't know. That is a really bad movie.
Now, the creators of Jaws and Star Wars bring you...
Indiana Jones.
A totally modern hero, trust me. And a new age of adventure. From the jungles of Peru to the streets of Cairo. From the greed of the pharaohs to the wrath of God. Raiders of the Lost Ark. Rated PG. Opens June 12th at a theater near you. Check local newspapers.
Adding on to what Stev said, though, I hate to keep sucking Red Letter Media's dick, but they're just that great. Is that they also said, yeah, that Indiana Jones, you don't really care for him about him as a character. You more or less just care about, like, the wish fulfillment part of it. Like, you want to be Indiana Jones.
Yeah, you know? Same with James Bond, I think.
He's like a character you want to, like, put yourself on.
Sue.
No, he's more like an appeal character. Like, you can kind of put yourself into his place. Like, I want to say author a self insert character, I guess.
I mean, the reason Raiders works is because it's not about Indiana Jones; it's about his adventures.
Yeah.
Whereas the other ones try to make it about him, and that's a bad idea.
Yeah. Fourth one tries to tie up his arc neatly just to put him to rest, even though it's like with Indy, it's like you don't want him to be put to rest. You want him to, like, you want to be able to imagine those adventures with Indiana Jones.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, when you give him a definitive end, it's just like, well, shit, I guess that's it for him.
Mm-hmm.
I guess he's old and now he's married and he's just gonna quietly live the rest of his life. That's his end.
And then Shia LaBeouf is gonna fall asleep in the theater row and he watches it in his movie marathon.
So, is that all for whatever Doctor Who thing you guys were talking about?
Oh, I just wanted to rant about Clara, and then I'm gonna get. I can't wait to read through the comments and see how people hate me now.
Yeah, we kind of. This was like the ranty podcast.
Let's see how many Whovians are in the pot on the comments. But we still have more news stories, apparently. Okay. Well,
is this like the news pot? We're not going to do Q&A. This is just the news.
I have two, but I guess I can save the second one for next time. But okay. I guess the major news is that Hey Arnold is also returning for a TV movie where he's going to find his parents, and original creator Craig Bartlett is involved.
Huh. So, yeah, define involved.
I don't know, but the Jungle Movie, it's fucking happening. It's
where he finds his parents are adventurers.
Yeah, but you know what I'm imagining? Like, here's my fan theory on what's going to happen. Like, in the show Hey Arnold, like, it ends on him finding his parents, except when he finds them in the jungle, they're just a skeleton, and there's just they're just carrying a little piece of note, and the note says, "Bye, Arnold."
Ouch. Damn.
No. No, the Damn. Note instead reads, "Football head."
But I think it'd be the perfect ending, like, "Hey, Arnold. Bye, Arnold." It just ends. It's the perfect. It goes
on
a loop.
Oh, wow.
Book opens, book closes.
Yeah. Perfect. Like,
if they're actually literally like finaling it, where like there's going to be no more, it could be See Ya, Arnold. Like, that's the title of the movie.
Oh, that'd be sad. It's like, it's over. No more Hey Arnold ever in the history of the universe after this. That's it. Oh, well.
Nickelodeon's doing a lot of, like, bringing back stuff, like, because they apparently only have SpongeBob and they need to bank on something.
Yeah.
I think it's interesting that Nickelodeon's been doing more of, hey, let's go back to the same thing and continue it, while any other network, especially Cartoon Network, would have been like, all right, how do we, like, take the name and then retool everything to where it's new and exciting? I find that interesting. Different mythology, or... idea.
Well, they don't have anything. All they have is what, Sanjay and Craig, and what's that other show?
I don't know.
Ninja Turtles.
Oh, yeah, they're coming out with Loud House.
Oh, Ninja Turtles does well, doesn't it?
Oh yeah, it does.
So yeah. I mean, they also don't... Power Rangers.
Yeah, you don't hear anything about the Ninja Turtles or Power Rangers, and it's just like those are two pretty big properties. Yeah. And Nick's just like, hey, here they are.
Well, the good thing is Ninja Turtles still sells toys, so that show is going to be around forever.
I mean, they're in space now.
Are they really?
Yeah. Are they
in
the show?
Yeah, four seasons in space. Like, the first two seasons are just like generically New York. And then season two is like, hey, we're at the farmhouse from the movies and comics. And then like season four is they're in space.
Fuck everything.
Is it at least good?
What's that?
Is it at least good?
It's all right. After they went into space, I kind of lost a little bit of interest. They're hanging out with the Doctor from Doctor Who. But as a robot.
No fuck.
Like they're literally traveling space and time with the metal robot voiced by David Tennant.
Fugitoid?
Fuck.
Yeah, the Fugitoid.
He's voiced by David Tennant?
Yeah.
Does he not have anything better to do?
He did Jessica Jones.
Oh. Jessica Bones, more like it.
Man, if I make a cartoon, I'm going to see if I can get David Tennant. It probably won't be that hard.
Please be in our show.
Hey, David Tennant. It's me, Nolan Baker. I really liked your show, Dr. What? And I would really like it if you were on my cartoon. I really appreciate it. Love, just, Nolan.
Just tell him you're Tom Baker's son.
P.S. may or may not be related to Tom Baker. If you want to find out, come over to our recording studio and talk.
just say these lines. Write the script around, hey, wait, you're not Tom Baker's son. I'm not doing this shit.
it could work.
He could play a robot who's programmed to only say, hey, you're not Tom Baker's son.
It's on the production levels of the Gem movie where they just get like random celebrity quotes and mix it into the script.
Oh my god. Yeah, that's true.
Yeah,
you know how many people ask me, like, the Gem movie's like a hidden artifact now. People are like, you saw it? What was it like?
Because it was on theaters for 2 weeks and they just like took it out.
I tweeted after it got pulled, I was like, in the future I'm going to be like Han Solo in the Force Awakens trailer. And I'm like, it's true. All of it.
I was there opening day. You guys don't believe me.
Like, are they even, I'm curious if it's coming out on DVD or if Universal's like, nah, fuck this, bro. Oh. It's just sitting in the vault.
Shit. Oh, but speaking of unreleased material, I guess we can go into this news report since it's kind of related. So, you guys remember the anime Afro Samurai?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, totally.
No one remembers it. It was on Spike TV, and I think it was a big deal at the time, and everyone just forgot about it now. But
well, Samuel L. Jackson was the main voice, wasn't he?
Yeah. But Afro Samurai 2, well, they made a video game, Afro Samurai 2, the sequel to the first licensed game from forever ago, and they released it on PlayStation Network and Steam, and it was there for like a week, and they pulled it down, and anyone who downloaded it, it was uninstalled from their computers because it was so terrible. The game company said, look, we were canceling the two other sequels we had planned for this game, and no one can play this. We're sorry, here's your money back. Pretend this never happened.
Whoa.
I just... How badly do you have to fuck up? Like, oh, wait, Konami did the same thing with PT, in a sense. Like, they tried everything in their power to erase it, to be like, listen, we fucked Kojima over. We fucked him hard in the ass. No lube, no condom, nothing. Mm-hmm. And we want you to fucking forget about Silent Hills, please. Thank you.
Hey,
well, to be honest, this isn't that uncommon.
Yeah, but it's like, I never heard a game company said, you know what, we're so ashamed of this game. Here's your money back. Pretend this never happened.
Well, I mean, like, I've seen Kickstarters do it. Like, remember that Yogscast game, like, a year ago? It was in, like, 3 years of production, and they're just like, well, it's canceled. They didn't get money back. They're just like, well, we made $3 million. We spent, like, two. I guess we just keep $1 million.
Aren't there, like, laws against that?
Well, they gave everyone a code to download it someone else's game.
Not with Kickstarter, there aren't. That's why people kind of don't like crowdfunding stuff, because... you could basically like make a product and fund it through Indiegogo or Kickstarter, and it could be a huge product. And you'd be like, hey, I donate to this. And you're like, well, you don't own a piece of it. You just kind of gave them money with no strings except for the rewards. That's all you get.
Yeah, you're not like a producer. You're not like...
Well, I mean, I guess... If
one of the tiers is like producer credit.
But you still don't get, like, you're not getting a percentage. You're not getting 5% like a real producer. You're just getting a vanity producer credit.
Mm-hmm. Listen. It none of that matters, just so long as my name's on the screen.
Yeah.
You could arguably, if it's a film, like, I guess games work too, but you could probably get an IMDb and just start becoming
a producer. You do. On some of them, I've seen that credit. Like, you'll be listed on it as IMDb.
Yeah.
And I've kind of wondered... Is there someone who's literally paid their way into having a producer career? Like, they have all these credits from Pixar, from crowdfunding. And like then they can go to someone and go, well, I have a producing career. Look at all these things I've produced. And it would be justifiable, you know? That's kind of fucked up. Think about that. Yeah, I bet you someone's done it. If someone hasn't, I'm very surprised.
I was shocked to find out I have an IMDb.
What?
Like, I've animated stuff for Yo Mama, so I guess Yo Mama's IMDb worthy.
Wait, my mama?
Yo Mama!
Oh my god.
Don't talk about my mama. That's not cool.
I'm sorry, Jim.
Hey, Jim.
I offended everyone on this podcast.
Speaking of Yo Mama, guess who's your father?
Who?
Me.
Oh. No.
He's your daddy.
I'm your daddy.
It's weird. It's weird that so many of these niche web shows have like IMDb's. Like, I don't have an IMDb as far as I know, but like I've seen
TV Tropes page. I want a TV Tropes.
No one uses that. But
fuck you. I use it.
Well, you know. But anyway, like these niche web shows, like web shows that have like 100 subscribers, like these reviewers who wanted to be on like That Guy with the Glasses or something have IMDb's, and they're mm-hmm. they're listed and stuff, and they have actors credited in their work as archival footage, which is like, this is a web show, this shouldn't count as IMDb worthy, especially if you have only like 100 subscribers on YouTube.
Yeah, no, let's see here, there was something that popped up. Like Angry Video Game Nerd, he considers all his reviews films.
Does he or like, someone else?
No, he himself, he like, I remember him like advertising his Kickstarter for his movie, and he was just like, yeah, I've been making reviews on the internet for years. I've between that and my other school, you know, like his projects from school, I've made over 100 films. Like, I don't consider reviews films.
His reviews have more production value than other reviewers. Like, there's
that's true
setup and stuff.
Hello, I'm the nostalgia critic. Please look at my face at one still shot.
Mm-hmm.
Although now he's trying harder.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but no, it sucks when people do that for their whole videos.
I guess I would consider it more of a TV show, you know, than a film.
I suppose, yeah. But you know what's even worse than that?
What?
when you have like a shot, but then you just cut to another shot, and then you just cut back to the first shot, and that's all you do the whole review.
Well, no, I think the people that do that are like really smart, and they really know what they're doing, and oh, it's really, really good idea. Yeah, no, that's what I think.
Yeah, are you sure?
I think that's like a great idea, and those people should be credited for their great production style and editing.
I know you're doing a bit.
I especially love it when the cameras are two completely different qualities.
Well, you know, maybe some of these people can't, you know, they do what they can with what they have, and they're doing a great job with it. Maybe people should say that. Maybe
I know you guys are doing a bit, but real quick, for your Rent review, did you do that whole thing in one take?
Yeah, I always do.
Like there's no cuts. I mean, I wound up. Oh man, this is 12 minutes of him talking. I'm gonna like do.
Oh no, I shot like 30 minutes, and then I cut.
Okay, because like I kept like not seeing any cuts, and it seemed to be like this one stream thing. It was almost as great and as awful. Well, not awful, but like pans little bit where he goes on for like a half an hour of just like one long sentence.
I cut out.
Well, you mean the one where I say. Teen girl who just got off watching Phone with the Squirrel on Newgrounds.com while trying to bring back Invader Zim petition wearing a Jack Skeleton hoodie and Happy Tree Friend tube socks version of Hot Topic during an Emily the Strange buy one get 150%. Fuck! Don't let me back in.
I'm going, oh, that's not cool. Oh.
I'm back.
I didn't mean to set that one up. I legitimately was like kind of hoping he wouldn't do it.
But look, like I actually recorded that, but I cut up a lot of it. So my breaths where I'm talking, but the in betweens, you know.
Oh, okay. So that wasn't just you being like really amazing.
No, I'm a fucking fraud. I actually like cut all my when I'm talking.
No, I do that. I do that. I cut all the breath because it's like it's a web video. You don't want to, you know. You want to get everything out and do it quickly. And
well, the best thing about doing web is, and it's kind of like sleeping into reality TV shows too, is that like you, if you were recording a review and you needed to make a cut where you were saying something, you would have to change the camera angle and then go back to it or show footage of what you're talking about and then go back to it as like an easy way to like hide the cut. Mm-hmm. But now, thanks to vlogs, you can just cut. All right, you fixed it.
Yeah.
Oh, no effort.
I hated those vlogs that just like instantly cut to each sentence. It just.
Actually don't like the ones that are just like they just shoot it in one take. Mm-hmm. Those like I really like, and there's no editing at all. Those really bug me because then you have to hear them. First off, they're going to talk about, "Hey guys, sorry it's been a while since I made a video. You know, things have been busy. I had to really clean my apartment. It was getting bad, and I had to pay some bills, and the work's been tough. Anyway, so I wanted to talk about, oh, shit, where's my phone? I'll be right back. Anyway, and then it's like a half hour before you get to the review, and there's stuff that should be cut out, and it's just, I don't like those at all, to be honest.
This reminds me, like, during the whole Cool Cats versus I Hate Everything debacle, like, that came out. There was a lot of people who made vlogs about it, and I was just clicking through some of them, and there was this guy who, like, the first 2 minutes of his Cool Cat rant is just him saying, "Hi, guys. So, anyway, I know I pissed off a lot of people in my previous videos, but it's only because I don't believe in Christianity, and look, atheism, we're in the right, okay?" Like, he just goes on this, like, 2 minute rant on how he hates religion. It's like, I came here for Cool Cat, man.
Yeah, or I like the one where they do a review and they go, "Just so you know, this is my opinion. So it's like justified. It's not your opinion. So this is just what I feel." And I'm like, yeah, you're talking. I know this is how you feel. You don't need to. Oh my God. That's like, that's one of my biggest pet peeves is when people go, "This is from my perspective." And I go, "I can see that. You're right."
You have to say that though. But keep in mind that if you don't say that, and you have a big following, those little kids that watch you are going to just assume that's fact. Like, that's not an opinion. That is, like, legit, you know, that's how everyone feels. That's how it has to be. And then they'll go attack people on the internet.
Oh, I thought you meant in real life, and I was imagining you have a really crazy cult kind of following, and you're like, guys, I really don't like this animator, and then they start pounding on his door at 3 a.m. with pitchforks.
Just a big bunch of following kids.
Well, I mean, they are teenagers, so their parents would be like, what the fuck are you doing up at, like, 3 a.m.? Mm. And they're like, Mom, I gotta go fight for somebody's honor online. And then they stop them from going out, so that in all honesty, they wouldn't leave the house. That's why they comment all the time.
Speaking of Cool Cat, we have a special guest for the next podcast.
What? Wait. Next?
Chris?
We don't... No. I haven't talked to him about an actual date yet, you fucker.
What the fuck, you idiot?
I said we're doing it this month. I'm gonna... he said to follow back up, like, sometime in December, so...
You...
I want to wait a little bit.
Fuck! Oh, well. Okay, so we may or may not have a guest, but I don't know. Who knows?
No, we do have him. I just gotta set up a date, you idiot.
Yeah. Gosh. We'll figure it out.
To fuck that one up, you retard. You
dumbass.
All right, I'll follow up with him right now if it makes you feel any better.
No, it's okay.
No, too bad. I'm doing it.
Okay. So, yeah, anything else?
What about life? Or?
I don't know. If you want to get into the questions, because I think Stead needs to go somewhere soon.
I do. I had like a previous engagement.
I mean, if you have to go anywhere now, that's cool.
Yeah, I guess now would be the time. Yeah. But there was one thing I was wanting to get your guys' opinions on.
Hmm.
Okay.
Recently, Game Grumps mentioned Chris Pratt in a video, and then they were just kind of like, "Hey guys, go get Chris Pratt to acknowledge us." And so as people with big followings that are Let's Players tend to do, their big following went to Chris Pratt, just kind of like. I want to say I won't use the word harassment, but it feels like it from a non-Game Grumps super fan and not someone that's associated with it. But like basically, you know, a shit ton of people just start messaging you, you know, filling your inbox with Game Grumps stuff. And like Chris Pratt made a tweet going, well, Game Grumps has some loyal fans. I can see why. They're funny. And then like everyone just seemed like it was this like big success.
Mm-hmm.
But from someone, the third party's perspective, I'm just like, how do you guys feel about that? Like, does that not feel like harassment? Or like, I could see Chris Pratt being like, they're loyal, like as like a way to be like, okay, guys, please stop messaging me.
Yeah, that seems really unprofessional. Just like,
yeah, that's not a good way to get to harass people into working with you. Because that's honestly, just in general, not that. Like, if anyone tries, not that I'm at the level of Chris Pratt in any sense of the word, but like, if anyone tries to get me to work on something for them, if they harass me, I'm really don't want to have anything to do with them. And I think if you're like Chris Pratt, and I'm assuming he's probably pretty busy, he's like, I will, you know, get this done so they'll stop harassing me and this will be over, but I'm never going to deal with these people again. And if you're going to get Chris Pratt involved, you probably like want to make that contact. So it's like doubly fucked you, because like not only are you going to go down as this person that Chris Pratt just shooed away, but you basically like he now knows he'll be at dinner with a producer and he'll be like, yeah, these fucking guys, like I had to turn Twitter off on my phone because I was getting too many notifications, or, you know, it was like it was so annoying. Like my messages were crazy because of these assholes. And let's say he runs some network that they were pitching to. It's like, it's such a bad idea, you know? So, I don't know.
It's just really interesting that Kotaku didn't like try to like spin it as either no one mentioned it. I didn't see it on any news site, but I could see Kotaku either spinning it in the way that I'm seeing it as like potential harassment and just kind of annoying a celebrity, or the other way around where it's just like Game Grumps got big celebrity through Twitter, you know?
I don't think there's no real good way of doing that and harassing someone, because people, like I was saying, people talk and it's going to ruin your reputation. And it's like the fact that that's their reputation is harassing Chris Pratt.
Well, I'm using the term harassment. I don't know if he was annoyed by it or not, but that was my perspective of like if thousands of people just started blowing up my Twitter to where it was no longer usable, and all of it was, go look at this thing, you know.
I mean, I think when someone's famous, we don't think about what their perspective is. And like, if you think about it from like, if you were on Twitter and that happened to you, you would be like, what the fuck is going, like, you'd be pissed off. And I think, like, you know, Chris Pratt probably doesn't want to put on a face where he gets mad at them, because they would, of course, leak that email or something. But, like, you know, you did. I don't think they thought of him as a person. They just thought of it as an opportunity. It's just a shit. I don't know. I think it's shitty, but I don't know the situation that well. So,
yeah. Well, this is not me like slamming Gang Grumps or anything and saying they're assholes. It's more of like, just remember your power when you have 2 million people following your YouTube channel. I think it was kind of like going back to like, saying something about someone and then you're following just accepts that, like, if you're a viewer and say you're a big famous reviewer and you say, Homeward Bound's awful, you just persuaded like a good majority of your fan base, well, I mean, them seeing the movie or them caring, or they just automatically convert to that mindset.
I was talking with some person at Comic-Con and they were telling me how they hate this one reviewer online who takes these cartoons too seriously, and they keep getting like death threats and harassing emails saying your work is awful. Like, they never use Twitter, but they keep getting this message because of from these fans of this one reviewer, and they just hate this guy because he takes things too seriously. It's like, no, shut up. We hate.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I hate to really say this, but like, fans are kind of sheep. They can be really sheepy. Like, and like, there are also, of course, there are always fans who are intelligent and like know where boundaries are. But some fans are like, oh, I must defend their honor. Oh. And like, they just go at it. And it's just like, you fucking need to chill, bro. Like, you can't do that. You can't say these things or like go white knight for this fucking guy you don't even know. It's just like, you need to calm down.
Yeah. You just have to be really careful. And like, I think me and Pan are kind of like in that right amount of people that follow us that like, we do have to be careful of certain things we say. Like, it wouldn't be as drastic as, say, like Markiplier randomly said, like, all right, guys, you know what we should do? People should just start taking down mailboxes. Ah, you know. And then there's no mailboxes the next day.
Someone smashed my mailbox a couple years ago.
Whoa. Damn Markiplier.
Yeah, fuck him for destroying my mailbox. I don't know, just think back to that one episode of King of the Hill where that one employee of Strickland got a whole bunch of MySpace followers somehow.
Oh, I remember that.
And that got, like, someone beat up, I think, Buck Strickland. So, oh, same with the American, that one American Dragon episode where Jake Long was blogging, like, man, fuck my principal, my teacher, he's an asshole, and all these magical creatures decided to put, like, a hit out on him. That was kind of fucked up now that I think of it. Yeah.
American Dragon is a completely different show than I remember.
All these followers started listening to him like, we gotta kill this fucking teacher. And like, he even tried to stop them, but they were like, no, Jake, we have to do this. We have to stop him. We must kill him.
That's kind of like online stuff now. It's like, they'll just go after somebody. And sometimes it's like totally ruin people's lives. It's like kind of, I don't know, it's scary.
Yeah.
Some of that stuff. Like, or your whole like, if anyone Googles you, that's what'll come up, is just that, like, nothing else about you. And it's like, just because of either a mistake a person made or because they just got wrapped up into something, and it can really ruin your reputation. Oh. I don't know.
Do you know the story about Ocean Marketing?
No, what's that?
Okay, so like 2 years ago, there was this person who was ordering this device, and I don't know, there were some issues with the shipping. Like, they didn't know what it was called. Like, I mean, they didn't know when it was being shipped, and they said, hey, what time of day are you guys shipping it, and when will I receive it? And the guy just replies, December 10th. And that's it, literally just December 10th. Like, was that the shipping date or the day it'll arrive? And they kept doing exchanges, and eventually the guy at the other end, the marketing company, run by one guy, is just a complete asshole and just starts belittling the person and starts being the smartass. And eventually, that webcomic, I was gonna say control delete, who runs PAX? Penny Arcade got wind of it, and they just made it this big thing of how much of an asshole this guy was. And he was just like taking it easy, like, yeah, what are they gonna do? And eventually they just destroyed his reputation. Look up Ocean Marketing. It's a fucking mess.
Wow.
Wait, but they also found the guy's personal YouTube page, and it was just him being, like, one of those douchebags who's in the middle of a suburb, and he has his motorcycle, and he's like, yeah, look how loud my motorcycle goes, vroom, vroom, in the middle of the suburbs. It was, like a frat boy running a marketing company.
Wow.
Ocean Marketing, look it up.
I don't know, that stuff, but I, like, just because if you Google someone, what will come up, and anytime there's a movie that's like really, really small, like super small, like there's nothing about them online practically. And they'll ask me if I'll review their thing. And I'll usually say no, because if I, let's say I'm the only one to review it and the only review is me bashing it, I just say no to it, because it's like, what if I just, they spent all this money and they just spend it to me. They send it to me. And then the only thing there is me going like, this is a bunch of crap. Don't see that. Don't see this scene.
I've had that with reviews, like devices.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I get a lot of Chinese, like, I made a tablet. I send it to you. You do review? And, like, one of the tablets didn't work, and they still wanted me to do review. And I'm like, are you sure? And I just didn't have the heart to be like, it didn't work. Don't buy it.
No, it's like, I've talked to other people who've said the same things, like, because certain people were doing, like, smaller movies for a little bit. But if you don't give it a glowing review, because it already has so many things against it already, you know, it kind of doesn't, not that you should only do smaller movies to give them great reviews, but it's like, if no one's going to see it and the only thing you can Google is like you going like, eh, it's okay. You're not, you know, I feel bad about that. It's different when it's like Jennifer Lawrence. I think she'll be okay. Maybe. I don't know. Yeah. Maybe she watches all my stuff and is like really upset. She's like, God damn it.
Oh.
He didn't like any of the Hunger Games.
Darn.
But I don't think that's true, though.
I need to head out. Thank you guys so much for letting me be on the podcast again.
Oh, no problem. It's always fun, man.
It's fun having you. Take care.
Okay. Yes. Bye.
Enjoy your question.
Yep.
We should do the questions.
Yeah, let's get into the questions. I've been meaning to go through them forever ago.
Sorry, this got, like, kind of ranty and stuff.
Man, it makes it more interesting when we're going off topic.
Well, just in time for St. Patrick's Day, crowds are coming by the dozens to get an up-close view at what some say is a piece of Irish folklore.
To me, it looked like a leprechaun to me. All you gotta do is look up in the tree. Who else seen the leprechaun say yay? Yeah!
Questions. If anybody has a question, be sure to start out with the word question so it's easier to find.
So, yeah.
First question is Sage Smith. Question: after remembering that time Nolan talked about how a guy did a perfect Napoleon Dynamite impression and it was on the news, it reminded me of a local news segment about bronies. So my question is, what's the strangest local news segment you've seen?
Oh, I have a good one.
Okay.
Kind of. This is like a notorious, if you're from Maryland and my age, you know it. Because I used to bond with anyone in college. If I met someone from Maryland, we'd talk about this. It gets really hot in the summer in Baltimore. And everyone goes, oh, it's so hot. You could probably make cookies in your car. You know, people say stuff like that. And this one news, it was not a slow news day, but Baltimore doesn't like to report on murder. So instead of reporting on important things, they decided to see if they could fry an egg on the on the parking lot. And they did. And they would just keep cutting back to them and go, so how's that egg working out?
Well, did it work?
I believe it did, but it was like kind of like this weird, like you kept watching it like, this is real? Like there's probably like police abuse going on, but they're like, hey, how's that egg going? Well, it's pretty hot, so it's working pretty well. We put butter on the ground. It was like, that's the most bizarre thing I've ever seen.
Life was simpler back then.
It wasn't. They were just bigger assholes.
But for a local news report where I was, I don't know. I just remember, like, I don't remember the news report exactly, but you know how when a news reporter is talking and they have, like, an image on their side of their head about the topic, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I just remember there was just an image of a car turned upside down in the middle of, like, the street. Like, it got into a crash. And on top, there was just a caption that reads, oops.
That's funny.
Oops. That's like, that's really belittling the situation right now.
I think another one I saw is, I was in Oklahoma once and I watched the local news and they did a whole segment on how to dress for the football game. And I was like, wow, you have a really small viewing audience that you were like, how to dress for the football game the next day. And that's your look. I mean, that's like there's no way your audience is that small. Jesus. I was like, holy shit.
They got to fill that spot with something.
They're like, we could talk about foreign policy or which poncho is best for you.
So next question, Moe Unicorns. Question, what's that symbol on Nolan's t-shirt? We never answered this on the podcast.
I think we did, but it wasn't like in a question. When Pan asked, like in the first few episodes, we didn't have avatars. So Pan was like, that's kind of boring. Can you guys like give me some designs of like what your avatar should look like? And I was like, well, shit, I don't really have anything. So I just drew me on my shirt. I was just like, you know what? Fuck it. I'm going to do it. I just drew Jake the dog wrapped up in a web cocoon. And I was like, yeah, I'm going to jack it to this. I'm going to make him draw that. And that's basically what it is.
Yeah. So it's a very simplified version of Jake the dog tied up.
It's sort of one of those minimalist loss edits.
Yeah.
You see on Tumblr.
So yeah. It's not a pill. It's just a minimalist design of Jake the dog tied up.
Pan sort of did it, and I sort of have that shirt.
I mean, no, you can buy that shirt on the Redbubble page, but like Nolan really loves that one episode of Adventure Time where with the spider.
Listen, that was not a good episode.
Hey,
I just wanked it a lot. Okay,
but it really impacted your life, didn't it?
It changed my life.
Yeah.
No, funny story about that, though. I watched that episode in my living room, and my family was in the other room, and they had to hear fucking spider delivery on the goddamn screen. I was like, this is so fucking awkward. And to hear, like, a spider give birth, and I was like, Jesus Christ. Oh, thanks, no. Adventure Time.
Did you buy some organic web shooters from, like, Target of Spider-Man?
When I was younger, I did.
Yeah.
I remember doing that and then going to my dad's car and spraying webs all over. And I was like, Dad, Spider-Man was here. Because I thought I could trick him. And he was like, Nolan, okay, Nolan.
He was like, everybody gets one.
Oh, he's going to like get revenge and just throw a giant rotting pumpkin in your room. Like, look, son, Green Goblin was here. Asshole.
I like that.
Just this gigantic rotting pumpkin that's just turning green and has mold on it all over your room splattered. That'd be awesome.
No, my Metal Gear Solid 5 poster.
Yeah,
my Spider-Man revenge would be making sure the mops always fall out of the closet.
Shut the fuck up.
Sorry.
Thanks to whoever made that. Oh, wait.
No, mine would be replacing all your Spider-Man DVDs with just deeper cuts of Revenge of the Madman Men YouTube poop on DVD. And it's every Spider-Man DVD you own, just that YouTube poop.
Yeah.
See, I think it would be worse if you changed every Spider-Man DVD someone had with Spider-Man 3.
Yeah, that's worse, but it's not funny then. It's just kind of suffering. I don't want anybody to suffer.
Oh, okay. Oh. That's true. That is pretty hard to...
Too soon. So, next question. Dipper 723. Question. Are there any inaccurate facts about a cartoon that a lot of people believe that annoy the hell out of you? For me, it's the SpongeBob Parents Are Cookies thing. That annoyed the hell out of me. It's SpongeBob SquarePants, not Cookie Bob SquarePants. SpongeBob's parents are obviously sponges because he's a sponge. It's scientifically inaccurate for a cookie to give birth to a sponge. And why would a cookie be living under the sea in the first place?
What the fuck?
So any fan theories or like things people believe about animation that you hate?
Well,
that's not true.
Okay, so that's the question.
There is like a really, there is one film thing that people believe that does annoy me. And that's that people believe like there wasn't color film until Wizard of Oz. That's like the big one. People like, I was told that till I was like 18. I was like 15. I took my first film class and they tell you like, yeah, that's not true. I don't know where anyone, that like no one knows how that can happen. But there was color film like 20 years before. It just didn't really start to take off till then. But people really believe that when that's people were like astonished when she opens the door and she's in Oz. Like people were but not because it was color film. They'd seen color film before. That's like my big one. Sorry. I know that's not animation.
Well, that kind of takes the impact away from Oz then. That kind of sucks, but...
No, it was still impact. I mean, it's not like... But it was still impactful because it looked like they hadn't seen that kind of color film. But like Gone with the Wind came out the same year, and that's in the same color. So it wasn't as astonishing as they make it out to be. They'd seen stuff in color before.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But it is true that no one actually saw in color until about 1935. Everyone just saw in black and white. So that might be why.
Yeah.
That might
be okay.
Did you ever read Calvin and Hobbes where Calvin's dad tells Calvin, where he's like, that like, no, it wasn't the film. Like everything was in black and white back then. And Calvin's like freaking out.
Yeah. I mean, sometimes it's hard for me to imagine like whenever I think like the 20s, like I always picture it in black and white just because we've only seen black and white photos of it. Like it's really hard for me just to imagine it in color.
Like, I mean, they've only recently found color photos from World War II. Yeah. Like there weren't that many, and they've more recently been trying to show more color photos from that because it makes it more real to people. There's like kind of a separation. I like black and white, but it feels more like it's not real because obviously we see in color.
Yeah.
So.
Shit, I had a thought. I lost it. Go on.
Sorry I went on that long thing.
No, it's okay.
But for any fan things that people say is true, like, I don't know. Like, I don't know if this is true or... Well, I don't know if this thing is true or not, but, like, some Anna messaged me saying, yeah, I know the guy who worked at Klatsky Shuplo, the creators of Rugrats, and every day he gets messages on if the Rugrats were in the Purgatory Theory, if that's true or not.
I fucking hate that one, too.
Stupid.
Like, there's people who, like, look at fan theories and all these like creepypasta stories, and I mean I'm interested in that because it's interesting, but I don't think it's real ever. Like, no one thinks Dead Bart is real unless you're stupid.
What Dead Bart isn't real?
What? Oh no,
are you fucking kidding?
Yeah, sorry Nolan, it was never real. It's just some fucking lies, bunch of bullshit. Yeah.
God. I hate my life. What's the point now?
You wasted everything. Oh, but there's like this one edited screenshot in Teen Titans where Beast Boy is looking at a magazine. Like the original thing, it says Hot Rod, but someone edited it so it says Hot Rape. And people think that was real. It's like, no, that's not real, you fucks. Unless... What?
I love how people like put in explicit stuff, like edit in explicit stuff. And they're like, whoa, it's real. It's real. And then like it's so obviously something that would not have gotten past the censors. Like, I mean, censors can be really stupid, but come on, guys.
Yeah, there's still some people who think adult party cartoon was part of the Nickelodeon run of Ren and Stimpy.
What?
Yeah. Jeez. For anyone who doesn't know, there's two Ren and Stimpy cartoons, one on Nickelodeon and later one on Spike TV where it was mature and they can get away with everything, and it was awful because they relied on just the fact that, hey, isn't this shocking? We don't have any jokes, but isn't this gross? Yeah.
Yeah.
And people confuse the two. I think there's some other ones.
For a video game, I was kind of responsible for like spreading a fake thing on Tumblr.
Oh, right. Wasn't it for Undertale and you...
Yeah, it was Undertale, and I was like, hey, have you guys seen the secret scene where the one spider character wraps up Sans? And like that has like 12,000 votes, and everybody's like, oh my god, you guys, Toby Fox is so cool, makes all these he makes all these Easter eggs, he's so... Oh, there's so much specific stuff, and I'm like...
You convinced an entire fandom that there was this bondage fetish for one of the characters.
Yep.
You.
That's so Nolan.
That's Jim. You sound so done. You're just like, oh my god, this degenerate.
I'm trying to. Oh, you know which one I hated was the Crybaby Lane one.
You mentioned it before
because it wasn't true. I love when people just, you'll be like, yeah, there's no basis in that, and they're like, no, but if you think about it and go, yeah, well, if you think in fact though, it's not. So
yeah, it was all a fraud. But crap. It also irks me whenever someone confuses creators. Like, they always confused, like, there was these old posts back when My Little Pony was super popular, that, hey, Lauren Foss also created the Powerpuff Girls. Like, there's, I think, news reports saying that. And I was really? Like, no, she didn't. No, you fucks. Like, I know these things. Why can't everyone be pathetic nerds of animation like I am?
I've seen that a bunch of times where suddenly they'll get a little trivia and, like, run with it.
Yeah.
And it's just, like, I don't know what... I don't really understand it. It's a bit silly.
And, of course, like, whenever there's a... People confuse something for a Disney film or a Pixar film, that hurts.
Oh, that happened... I've noticed that happens a lot, and with how the Marvel Cinematic Universe works, they're like, and when are the X-Men going to get involved? And you're like, no, they can't. That's Fox. And, like, no, but it's Marvel. And I go... Yeah, I know, but it's a different... And then, like, you can tell they don't really understand. Like, you're like, okay, never mind. Or, oh, the one I hate... Oh, see, all the ones I'm thinking of are movie ones, but the James Bond is a code name theory, I don't like that much. Wait. And I've heard they... Wait, do you know this theory?
Wait, I thought James Bond was a code name.
Oh, no, it's just, like, it's just the guy's name. They just... It just always changes. There's so no continuity.
Just, so every time they hire someone... Well, They just happen to be named James Bond?
Well, they didn't start continuity till recently. So it's just like, it just constantly reinvents itself.
Huh. So
there's no, like, overarching, like, thing to it until they started doing the Daniel Craig stuff.
So essentially, are we supposed to, like, pretend that Sean Connery and Daniel Craig were the same person in a way?
No, it's just different versions of... It's just different stories.
Kind of like how a comic book with two different artists, where they draw Peter Parker the different style, you know?
Yeah, that's probably a good way to think of it.
Yeah.
But there's not, like, that's, people have used that theory to, like, give it some continuity. That's the other thing I've noticed, is we have so much continuity now, people try to make continuity. Because it feels like now that's how people understand story. Like, how there's a Tarantino universe... I've heard that one, but that one gets confusing because there's the Tarantino universe and then there's the universe of Tarantino movies that are movies that people in Tarantino's universe watch, like Inglourious Basterds, Django, and Grindhouse are movies they watch, and Pulp Fiction, Jackie Brown, and Reservoir Dogs are his real universe, and, like, big movies in their universe are those other movies.
Mm-hmm.
That's confusing.
Yeah.
Or the Pixar theory. Anyway, sorry.
I like them for fun. Like, I don't take them seriously.
No. I think they're... Sometimes they can be a lot of fun. Like, you can go, oh, I never thought of that. And yeah. Stuff like that. But sometimes I do feel like there are people who get too into them and they don't really know the point of the actual stories, you know?
Yeah. Hmm. So, next question. Tom Gyroid. This question is an all bold... Question, did you know Rebel Taxi can be connected to other internet shows by its Zone Tan cameo, ZTV, and Mr. Code crossover, which is also crossed over with other internet shows? That's his question. Like, I don't know, Tom Gyroid, stop messaging me the same question. We know I heard you the first time. What are we supposed to say to that?
I guess my answer is okay.
Yeah, okay. That's a response, Tom Gyroid. Okay.
Okay. All right.
Thanks. Thanks for nothing, thanks. Tom.
We get it. You didn't really need to make it all caps.
Thank you, Tom. You're the best.
God bless, Tom.
Yeah. Thank you. You don't need to ask that ever again.
We should buy him a gyroid. Like, make him feel better. Give him a gyroid, whatever those are. That's like a burrito, right?
A gyro?
A gyro?
Oh, a gyro. Okay.
A gyroid is like a...
C-Pan, you need to watch My Big Fat Greek Wedding again. Then you know.
Yeah, a gyroid is like, it is something, but it's, I would say, it's something from Animal Crossing.
That thing. Let's see. Let me see the other questions. Oh, this one's a long one. Senpai Samurai. Question. Dear Pan, I wrote to you, but you still ain't responding. I left my cell, my pager, and my homie phone at the bottom. I sent two comments back in autumn. You must not have got them. There probably was a problem with YouTube or something. Something my internet crashes when I got them. But anyway, fuck it. How's it been? How's the podcast? This goes on for like two paragraphs.
Oh my god. So it's just Stan, what it has to do with you?
Eminem Stan. And someone replied... Too edgy. Thanks, emo Nem.
Oh my god. Yeah. He doesn't have his girlfriend tied up in the trunk and he's gonna drive the bridge. God. Don't do that, man. Please. Calm down.
No, we'll buy you a gyro also.
Wow, you're buying everybody gyros tonight.
Like if there's ever like a public gathering of Pizza Party fans, we're gonna gather at some place that sells gyros.
So you think it'd be pizza. That's a twist.
Too expensive. We're buying gyros.
I think gyros are more expensive than pizza.
Robert Schullers. Question: what cartoon did your parents not let you watch?
Wait. Didn't watch or did watch?
Did not let you watch.
My mom banned me from watching Cow and Chicken and Ed, Edd n Eddy.
Oh, Cow and Chicken for me too, yeah.
I wound up watching them anyway, though, because I didn't give a fuck.
I can't think of... I wasn't allowed to watch... probably The Max, because I did want to watch that, because I was so into comics. I don't think I was allowed to watch, like... anything too, but I can't think of a specific cartoon. There was a comic I wasn't allowed to read because in the opening pages, this guy sleeps with this girl and then shoots her in the face. And my parents were like, you can't read this.
But speaking of the Max, speaking of the Max, like, have you watched that recently?
Last couple of years. Yeah.
Yeah. What was it about? I have no idea.
Oh, well,
you know, never mind. It's going to go into a whole nother thing. Fuck it.
No, well, I was just going to say, I think it's just a cool experience and it's just a weird, strange show. And it's, I don't know. I don't think it does kind of fall apart because you're like, what is this about? Like, it's just cool looking. I don't know.
Yeah. MTV's The Max with two X's at the end.
But I was allowed to watch Beavis and Butthead in its prime. But I everyone else in my neighborhood wasn't. My parents were like, I mean, you're not going to play frog baseball. It's fine. Who cares?
But like, my parents forbade me from watching The Simpsons because, well, I guess
that's a big one for a lot of people. What's up with that?
I know, like, and nowadays, like, Family Guy is the more controversial show. Parents won't let their kids watch. I mean, back then, The Simpsons was much more. Well, we thought The Simpsons was pretty, you know, explicit. I mean, it did a lot.
Why was that? Simpsons wasn't really that bad. Like, was it just because it was animated for adults and what they understood was animated for adults was like Ralph Bakshi and stuff?
Yeah, well, I mean, it's animation, so they assume it's for kids. But also, it's like pretty much kind of a parody of the traditional sitcom family, except this family is a bunch of assholes in a way sometimes.
Well, that was the big thing when it started, is it was going up against Cosby and they were like the ruder family and Cosby was the more moral family. I'm sorry, I couldn't keep a straight face through that.
Yeah. Well,
Did you see the Family Guy? This is going to make me seem super lame, but did you see the Family Guy thing where they made watching Cosby after knowing recent events and it's like the theme and all the women are passed out?
It was
okay. I was like, I'll give you that, Family Guy.
Speaking of the Cosby, there was an episode of Fat Albert and the Cosby Kids where they go to a scare straight program. Like, I think they do something wrong and the police take them to prison and they say, here's what happens if you mess up and go to prison. And there were very clear depictions of people like trying to lure them in like they're gonna do something, like, you know,
you mean prison rape?
Yeah. Like in this show, like, damn, this show did not hold back on teaching a lesson.
Well, that's why nobody wants to go to prison.
Yeah, thanks, Cosby. Yeah, so Cosby Bebop is ruined, the whole theme song. Remember Cosby Bebop? Classic internet.
You like a jump rope, don't you? You see, zip zop, zoom a da bop, boogie 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 man, boogie boogie
boogie boogie man. See, the thing is, though, I'm not gonna hate that show. I just hate that person.
Yeah,
because it's still a funny show. You know who? You know, I don't agree with him.
Which show again?
Oh, I thought we were talking about Family Guy. No, I'm sorry. No, I mean Cosby's.
Yeah. Gotta know.
See, how come this stuff can't happen to Seth MacFarlane?
Yeah.
How come it has to happen to Bill Cosby? I guess it didn't happen. I want to rephrase what I said. Didn't happen to Bill Cosby. Bill Cosby did this to people. I guess I don't want Seth MacFarlane to do this to people. You know what? I've just stepped in something. I'm going to slowly walk out.
We got
to
find like an innocent charge that he can be trialed for, like a pirating movies, you know?
Or being a Jared.
He gets arrested for pirating Family Guy episodes.
Actually, you know, an actor got in a lot of trouble in the 70s for having a huge collection of movies illegally. Roddy McDowall. Like, he was going to face serious charges for it. I don't think that would happen now, though.
Crap, what was even the question anymore?
Sorry, I'm not good at...
No, Mr. Meta. Two questions. What kind of thing appeals to you most in art style? What's appealing about an art style to you?
That's kind of a style over substance question.
Thick outlines and colorful stuff.
I like all sorts of styles. They're just not, I don't know. I guess if it looks cool, that's kind of...
Yeah.
If that it sounds looks really cool. Superficial. If you're just like, look at it and you're like, wow, that looks really stunning. But I don't really go like, I only want this style or that style. So I'm a bad person to ask.
Dumb. Yeah, same here. I like a lot of different styles, and there's a lot of different things I like. I mostly just like really, really detailed, really awesome, intricate drawings. Like, what I've been looking for a fucking like volume of Berserk, the manga, and I can't fucking find it no matter where I go. And I haven't tried online yet, but I'm hoping I can just find it in a bookstore for cheap. But that's not happening. But I've seen like a few images of Berserk's artwork, and it looks fucking gorgeous.
Mm-hmm.
I just like a lot of very well detailed, very intricate, yeah, drawings. That's, I guess, what I gravitate towards.
So yeah, but thick outlines and colorful stuff. That's great. Like Boondocks. I mean, Mission Hill.
You fucked up.
My style for Loki IRL. He should go read
that. Wow, that's conceited.
Look, I did what I love. Like, well, you know, it's like, what if I did something I hated? You know, that's, what's the point, you know? Their second question. If you only had 24 hours to live, what would you honestly think you'd be doing?
Masturbate. No, I don't.
Okay.
Sorry.
That's something I would say instantly, but no, you said it, Jim. You pulled the trigger.
Sorry. I guess I shot my wad too early. I don't think... See, I don't know. I would just try to have a good time. I would watch the bucket list while organizing my bucket list.
But my English teacher in sixth grade, he was telling us, like, what would he do if the world was ending? And his plan was to go to, like, Walmart and go and run through the shelves with his hands wide open and just knock everything down as he's running by.
Wow. Some people just want to watch the world burn. And your English teacher was one of them.
Yeah. That'd be so cool just to run through them, just fuck everything, destroy all these pickle jars.
What a modest thing to do. Like, the world's ending, you could do anything.
Yeah.
And go to Walmart. Like, he could do that today. What? Don't let the end of the world
I guess you could
back.
Say, no day but today.
Wow. Thank you.
I don't get it.
It's a Rent reference.
Fuck off.
And only Jim would know it because he saw the movie.
I got it.
That's the first time Jim's ever gotten one of my Rent references.
My English teacher was in porn once.
Oh, yeah?
Okay, so what happened was, here's what I heard from other kids in my high school. Like, we go to this school that's had middle school and high school together. Anyway, so they were watching a porno, I guess, and they were like, dude, is that Mr. Blank? It's like, holy shit, it is. And they tell me that they actually went up and asked Mr. Blank, we'll just call him that, if that was him. And from what they say, he didn't say anything and his face just turned bright red and they just awkwardly walked out the room.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's great. Well, you shouldn't judge if someone does. That's fine. Yeah. You probably needed the money.
Please don't judge anything I do, ever.
Look, he's getting paid to get laid. I can't get laid at all. So, you know, he's like superior, you know?
Yeah.
Don't slut shame.
Yeah, don't slut shame.
Yeah.
People get fired for that, so yeah. I hope he didn't.
Wait, people get fired for slut shaming?
Oh, no.
No, people get fired if you're a teacher and you're, like, in a porno or you're a stripper or something.
Yeah.
That happens a lot.
I mean, I always see, like, all these news reports, like, teacher was fired for uploading photo of themselves at the beach on their Facebook.
I have seen that. That's super not cool.
Yeah.
But it should say, if you read on, it's like, was fired for pictures of them at the beach, and it's like them with a Nazi swastika in a bikini. Yeah. I mean, that makes more sense. I'm like, I'm with you, school. With you.
They made a sandcastle in the shape of Castle Wolfenstein. There's a big swastika on the side. It's really disgraceful.
They're reading Mein Kampf, and there's a notebook that says, yes, I agree with Hitler, and stuff.
Yeah, what a shame. Like, I expected better.
You would agree with the school if you read more of the article.
Yeah, I mean, it's just like, the media makes it so vague that you just side with the teacher, like, hey, it can't be that bad. But also,
she was a huge Big Bang Theory fan.
Yeah, that too. I mean, it explains everything.
Also a big Rocket Power fan.
Oh, no. Oh, fuck. Someone just sent me a message. Dev Chips. I have a question. I have some Rocket Power figures I got out of a gumball machine about 10 years ago. Should I mail them to you so you can have the pleasure of destroying them? Or should I destroy them upon an unlisted video doing them myself? Wow.
Okay. So this is what happened to the kid from Toy Story?
Well, he's still out there. But Someone, okay, a couple of months ago, I kind of feel guilty for not reviewing it by now, but I get a lot of things in the mail. But someone, I don't know who, sent me a sealed copy of the Rocket Power PlayStation 2 video game Rocket Power Beach Bandits, and I don't know who it is, but someone out there spent the money on this crap, and I feel guilty for not reviewing it by now, but like,
you probably couldn't handle all those shoobies.
You should say, hey, everybody, I'm going back to the Tony Hawk retrospective, and then just review the Rocket Power game.
No, we're not ready for that. Rocket Power was not ready. Why did we hate Rocket Power?
Because Jim was like, no one's marathoning Rocket Power.
And there was a reason. I think you said Rocket. We were talking about how it wasn't good. And then you weren't here for one. I said, Nolan's marathoning Rocket Power. That's why I couldn't be here. And it just snowballed from all that.
Okay, I have two questions by two different users, but they're the same. Both a Bucket user and, let's see, Zane Powers both write, what's your opinion on the cartoon Drawn Together? Personally, I think it's awful. And that's their question. I immediately blocked both of them because I did not want to hear them diss on Drawn Together.
I haven't seen it.
I don't remember it very well. Oh. I don't think I watched it. Did you like it or something?
I love that show. Like, I think I watched it at the beginning, well, early on when I was starting to do Rumble Taxi videos, and that kind of influenced my humor to become more fucked up in a way. Uh-huh. So yeah, I would not be this.
And then you went mainstream and you dulled your blade, you fucking poser.
Well, fuck, I still make incest jokes. Let me read this one post off the official Drawn Together Facebook.
Oh god, that show is recent enough to have a Facebook?
Apparently. Well, they had a movie recently that nobody liked, not even the Drawn Together fans. This was after the movie was released and like everyone left, but here's a message by Dave Jester, one of the two creators. It says, we'll be honest with you, Drawn Together fans. It's been a rough couple of years. The pain of Drawn Together's cancellation has taken its toll on both Matt and myself. Our partnership dissolved, and we have gone in vastly different directions. Matt left the business and went on a church retreat to pray the gay away with a gaggle of 13-year-old boys. None of them have been heard from since. And after yet another bout with alcoholism, I was able to get my old job back selling life insurance. Understandably, Understandably, my wife left me after we lost the baby, and the only thing that keeps me going is weed. So smoke up. Happy 420. Love, Dave Jesser.
When was this?
April 20th, 2012.
Wow. You know what would be the most fucked up of all this is if that was the most genuine thing that guy ever wrote.
Yeah. If he died after this, like, I'd be happy.
His life is no longer of value. Just cut it off. Just cut the cord.
Yeah, you fucked up. You made John together. Your life's work is complete. Good night. Oh, so is this the end of the podcast?
I believe it is.
Yeah, it's been like 3 hours.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
I'm Pan Pizza. Who are you people?
I'm Jim.
I thought you were John Leguizamo.
Oh, hey guys, it's me, John Leguizamo. I'm also here. Maybe I'll do a duet with Emily after this.
Oh, I loved you in Spawn, by the way.
Thank you. I was the clown. I was also Luigi in the Super Mario Brothers movie.
You were really good in Spawn. Thank you. You're the best thing about Spawn.
I ate a pizza that had larvas on it, and I really did eat that, and I vomited it out.
So is that true?
Oh, yeah, that's true. He did eat a...
I got you to break. Yes.
Look. It's real dedication. Like in a scene in the movie Spawn, this clown guy eats a pizza from a dumpster, and the dumpster is full of larvas. And he really did eat that pizza full of larvas, except he vomited right afterwards. But you know, that was just dedication to get that on camera.
That's called being a fucking idiot.
Yeah,
for
the Spawn movie.
Spawn was my best movie next to Ice Age and the Super Mario Brothers movie and the Pest.
I think Romeo and Juliet was pretty good.
Oh yeah, I was in that, but I don't care. I was in the fucking sloth in that one. So is this the end of the podcast? Goodbye, everyone.
Bye.
I'm gonna go kill myself.
Oh, can I come too?
Yeah, come on, John Leguizamo. I made a second noose just in case anybody wanted to join me.
Oh boy.
Okay, I have the noose around my neck. I'm gonna kick chair.
This is gonna be fun.
Okay, bye.
Don't forget to buy the Super Mario Brothers movie on video and demand.
Bye.
It's a new day, but it all feels old.
It's a good life, that's what I'm told. But everything, it all just feels the same.
At my high school, it felt more to me
like a jail cell, a penitentiary.
My time spent there only made me see that I don't ever want to be like you. I don't want to do the things you do. I'm never gonna hear the words you say, and I don't ever wanna be you. Don't wanna be just like you. What I'm saying is, this is the anthem. Throw all your hands up, you. Don't wanna be you.